ABC Sports presents the seventh week of the USFL. The running-gunning Houston Gamblers and the New Jersey Generals, a shootout between quarterbacks Jim Kelly and Doug Flutie. And a very happy Easter to all of you as you see the skyline of New York City. And we're located today just across the Hudson River in New Jersey at the Meadowlands Giant Stadium for our presentation of the USFL. It's a day of some wind, partly cloudy skies, and reasonably comfortable. It's quite cool, and you'll see a lot of folks wrapped up today in their coats as they come out on this Easter Sunday. The featured performers today, of course, the two quarterbacks. Jim Kelly, who leads the Houston Gamblers run-and-shoot offense, and he's throwing the football at a record pace and completing passes at a record pace. And, of course, Doug Flutie, who quarterbacks the New Jersey Generals, who just the last week or so showed some temper as he felt he was being pummeled around unnecessarily a couple of times. So it's these two teams, Houston at 5-1 and New Jersey 3-3, that lock horns this afternoon at Giant Stadium. Hello again, everybody. I'm Keith Jackson, along with our analyst, Lynn Swann. And, Swanee, this, as you have defined it, a showcase for the two top young personalities in the USFL, both quarterbacks, Jim Kelly and Doug Flutie.
And they're outstanding young men, but they're both very, very different. Jim Kelly will hurt you with pinpoint accuracy throwing the football all day long and everywhere on the football field, and that's his strength. Where on the other side, Doug Flutie will hurt you because he's so unpredictable. You don't know where he is. He can hide behind that offensive line. He will run with the football and throw on the run as accurately as any passer in this league.
It is important for both teams here this afternoon, obviously. Anytime you can put a mark in the win column, it's important. New Jersey at 3-3. But the Houston Gamblers lost their first game last week of the season. They're now 5-1. And I think it's very important they don't let themselves get into a situation where they're going to lose 3 or 4.
They, I think, took the Baltimore Stars a little bit too lightly in that ball game, thinking they could press their receivers man for man and cover them all over the field. And the receivers took them apart, and particularly Mike Mitchell on that corner. And those corners are going to have a tough day today also, because one of the featured events in this ball game is a running attack led, named by Herschel Walker, and between the tackles, it's led by Maurice Carthen. And when they come on the outside and take on those corners, they're going to win the match.
So then the Houston people have got to come up with a major defensive effort, especially along the trenches, whereas New Jersey goes into the ball game without Tom Woodland. He's out.
Well, they're going to have to take care of that by rushing the passer a little bit more, getting more pressure on Kelly. Woodland is a predominantly run defensive tackle, so Lynn Mattson would come in passing situations. So with him out of the ball game today, it's not really going to hurt them. But what might hurt them is when they put more people on the line of scrimmage, is going to man-to-man coverage against the receivers. The guys are too fast.
Well, now, Houston has not played this year a real run-oriented team, a team that can just get down there and root it out with you like the Generals can.
The Houston Gamblers don't know what the run offense
right.
is. They only have one running back, and although Todd Fowler and Sam Harrell have done a great job for them, they just don't use them that much. They throw the ball 40, 50 times in the ball game. Now, when Herschel Walker and Maurice Carthen start pounding the defensive line of the Houston Gamblers, they are going to be in a lot of trouble. Pete Caton is out, Tony Fitzpatrick, they're all hurting on that defensive line.
I think it's also a valid point to be made, and it's made over and over again. You play best against what you practice against. And as you said, Houston doesn't run the football. The defensive people on the Houston side never practice against the run. They don't. Right now, let's spend a moment with Tim Brand as he talks to the Gamblers quarterback Jim Kelly.
Okay, Keith, Jimmy's putting on his plays here. He's getting all set. Now, I know you watched the success that Tampa Bay had thrown against the Generals, and they worked a lot on Justin. Are you going to work on that corner early and test him?
Well, we're going to try a little bit of everybody. With our receivers, we'll work on anybody. It doesn't matter to us.
Jimmy, now, we talked a little bit and touched on it with Sanders hurt and Johnson still not full. What kind of adjustment do you have to make? There's got to be a difference in speed, a little bit different reads.
I just have to keep my patience because they are new receivers in there, but they're capable of making big plays. I just have to just be patient with it.
All right, I've got to ask you this. I know you're not going against Flutie. You're going against their defense. but you're here in his hometown in the shadows of New York, national television, playing on the same field as Flutie. There has to be a little extra incentive for you.
Well, I'm just going to go out like I told you before and just play my game. I start worrying about that when I get off my game plan, and I just wish him all the luck, and I'm just going to go out and give 100%.
Okay, good luck to you.
Thank you.
Okay, Keith.
All right, Tim, and Houston won the toss, so the Gamblers will have the first offensive possession. And they do get Richard Johnson back today. He is a slot back and one of the primary targets for Jim Kelly. He will not start the ball game. He is coming off injury, but says he is fit and ready to go. So the Generals now, Roger Ruzek, will tee it up and kick it off. And the deep man, a very dangerous man for the Houston Gamblers because he is so quick and so fast, is Clarence Verdan. He is out of Southwest Louisiana. Back there with him are Calvin Eason and Sean Potts. Eason being the slower of the three. That man right there is the one they want to get the football. He broke a big one, 94 yards, in one of the games we saw earlier down at Tampa against the Tampa Bay Bandits. Verdan averaging just a tick under 30 yards per kick return. And the ball is hooked away from him and kicked out of bounds. So they'll bring it back, and they will move it back to the 30-yard line now. They kicked it in the direction of Sean Potts. So apparently, Ruzek had been told, don't kick the ball to Verdan. Give it to one of the guys on each side. And he tried to do that and was not successful with it. The wind is said to be blowing 8 to 15 miles an hour. It looks to me like it's blowing stronger than that here at Giant Stadium. And once it comes inside this big saucer, it swirls around, and it may affect all of the kickers today. Walt Michaels, the head man of the New Jersey Generals, and Jack Pardee, the boss man of the Houston Gamblers.
Keith, last week, David Trout was also trying to kick the ball away from McNeil and Verdan in situations like this, and he kicked it from side to side. Then they began switching Verdan and McNeil from side to side, trying to anticipate just where he was going to kick it to. And when he kicked it to the side, he ended up kicking to the man he wanted to kick away from.
Well, they just switched now, too, because Verdan now has come to the near side. He's trying to hide back there and hope that Ruzek hasn't seen him. That moves Sean Potts over into the middle. Potts is a wide receiver out of Bowling Green. So let's see whether or not Ruzek spotted it. He puts it in the air, and he goes right to Verdan at the 3-yard line. Pops out of there and almost broke it. He almost broke a big one, but trailing the play was Frank Mattias, and Frank brought him down. John Joyce was over there, but if he pops through that twosome of Joyce and Mattias, it would have been a foot race to the end zone. And now Jim Kelly comes out to crank up against the New Jersey Generals defense. Sam Horrell starts. Mark Baruse in there at a slot back. We expect Richard Johnson in the next series. Clarence Verdan, the other slot back, with McNeil and McGee, the wide people. McGee a little kimpy with a full hamstring. Taylor, Kerr, Khalil, Rosado, and Robinson, the big guys up front. And they move a lot of people around as they go set now for the first snap of the ball game, with Baruse going in motion, and Kelly hands it off to Harrell. So they run it on the first play of the game. It works for about 2 yards up to the 20. The defense for the New Jersey Generals, Matty Ace is in the middle for the injured Tom Woodland, with Byrne and Lockett outside. I expect we'll see Gilbert quite a bit today if he's healthy. Leopold, Joyce, Clemens, and Weddington are the linebackers. And the secondary will be Justin Preston, Johnson, and Holmes, and probably Ken Johnson coming in as the nickelback, with Terry Daniels also. You may see six defensive backs out there some today for the New Jersey Generals. On second down and 8, Kelly throws it. Little quick pop in there, and it was Verdan looking at McGee. Verdan was the up man. McGee was the deep man, and it was sort of an Alphonse Gaston, and nobody caught it.
Well, he had two people right next to each other. There are actually three people in the vicinity, Scott McGee and Clarence Verdan, and they both turned to the inside, and there you see the congestion.
So they're looking at third down and 8 now, and Houston running about 34% this year on third down conversions. Vince Corville is in the lineup. And again, you have a lot of movement. We didn't see all this much movement last week by the Gamblers, and they run the clock down as Kelly drops and throws, and it is good. Caught up around the 34-yard line by Scott McGee, and he's got a first down for the Gamblers. Jerry Holmes was right there and had good coverage, but the pass was so well thrown that Jerry could not reach it.
As we said in the opening of the show, one of his great talents in passing the ball is his pinpoint accuracy. Now he's dropping back a lot more than he did last year. He stands in the pocket, fires it straight in there, and you see
McGee doesn't have to go very far to get that ball.
At the 34, it's first down for the Houston Gamblers. 5-1, the Generals 3-3. Both coming off losses. The Generals to Arizona and the Gamblers to Baltimore. And Kelly on a little short route to the sidelines to Verdan. It's good for about 3 yards, and that's all. Coming across was John Preston, number 25, out of Central State in Oklahoma to bring him down.
Now, Keith, he is a very physical football player. Now, when the New Jersey Generals played the Baltimore Stars, they missed his physical play through that entire ball game. He came back the next week to come in and make these kind of tackles. Now, this is what I think he will be trying to do. John Preston, number 25, all day long, trying to intimidate the smaller receivers for the Houston Gamblers.
140-pounder, number 13, Gerald McNeil, is now in there. He is the real speedster, probably the fastest of the fast. Little shot out here is deflected and knocked down. The pass intended for Vince Corville, and it was slapped down at the line of scrimmage. So Kelly taking a two-step drop that time, trying to set up a real quick one-on-one against Kerry Justin, and the ball is knocked down. So again, they're looking at third and long.
Jim Byrne, number 74, was the man in the right defensive end who tipped that pass.
Joyce, the middle linebacker, has dropped off the line of scrimmage. He's playing the short zone. He's about 5, 6, 7 yards off the line. Now he starts to flow with the play as Kelly's pass is away, and it's going to be down short, I think, of the first down. It depends on the mark. It was very close as Clarence Verdan came across to grab it. Preston hit him, and the mark is all important.
Keith,
and they'll measure.
Keith, it looks like it might just be a little bit short. It's going to be close regardless. But it looked like he marked it further back from where he caught the ball and actually hit the ground. We'll take another look at it from our end zone camera. The official has a tough call here. He's got a mark. You see right there, he's on the line when he makes a catch. Then he slides and contact is made. He still picks up the first
down.
Just
got it, didn't he? It would have been interesting to see what Jack Pardee might have decided to do on fourth down and a couple of inches there, but he doesn't have to make that hard decision as it is good for a first down, marked just short of the 45, and so the Gamblers now have picked up 2 first downs. Just getting underway on Easter Sunday.
One thing I want to point out, number 74, Rick Kerr, is a left guard. He's starting this game in place of number 60, Scott Boucher, because the coach felt that Scott Boucher might have been a little bit too light on this line this afternoon.
Good protection for Kelly. Verdan is wide open, and he is thrown down at the 41 of New Jersey. He was dancing around looking for some place to get into a foot race, but they simply wouldn't give him any room, and 3 of them converged to make the tackle, but it is a first down.
We'll see the kind of protection that Jim Kelly is getting early in the ball game. Plenty of time to find his receivers. That ball does not have a lot of loft on it. Gets it out there in a very short period of time. His receiver has a chance to make the catch to run. Now watch again the physical play of the secondary. You see Justin right there coming up, inadvertently grabbing the face mask, but he pulls his hand away.
Richard Johnson is in the lineup. He's been out 3 weeks with injury, but he's in there right now, and he's tough. Down the middle he goes to him, and Johnson comes up with it, and he's got another first down for Houston. Just inside the 27 of New Jersey, he caught that one in front of the nickelback, Ken Johnson, playing the right corner. That particular normally plays the right corner, but circling in the middle that time with Johnson.
To give you an idea of just how many passes are being thrown by Houston, after missing a number of games, Johnson is still the second leading receiver in the Western Conference, coming into this ball game with 29 catches, that one number 30.
He was a running back at Colorado, so he knows what to do with the ball once he gets it. He can make things happen. From the 27, first down, Houston. Kelly throwing. Gets it away to the end zone. It is picked off. Intercepted by John Preston. And Preston, looking for some help, gets it back there and turns it big up the field and across the 25, 27-yard line.
Keith, there is a penalty flag. But it's back around the line of scrimmage. Back around the line of scrimmage.
They had double coverage that time on the intended receiver, Clarence Verdan, and Verdan really had no shot at that ball. It's holding, and it's against the Gamblers. Referee is Ted Humphrey. The umpire is Ed Manning, the head linesman Jeff Bergman, the line judge Tony Viteri, back judge Chet DiStefano, the side judge Ted Colano, and Mike Looney is the field judge.
We'll take a look here at the isolation play. He's got Preston, number 25, underneath, who makes the interception, but you see Preston has help from another defensive back coming across the top. Where Kelly made his mistake was he tried to just touch that ball right in between tight coverage, and Preston, being a good athlete, timed it and went up as well as the receiver to make the catch.
Personal foul called against New Jersey has moved the ball back near the 10-yard line. So you had two flags, apparently one of them out of bounds over there.
Goal, 65, declined by rule. Personal foul, unnecessary roughness, 47, first down.
John Joyce getting into the spirit of things here early in the game. And when you're sending small receivers down into the middle like Houston does, the obvious is to get physical, and New Jersey is trying to do it. But that personal foul moves them from around the 27 back down to about the 10-yard line, and there's the first snap of the ball game as New Jersey also goes into motion with Sam Bowers the tight end, leading Maurice Carthen, the lone remaining back, and that puts Herschel Walker up into a slot position as Flutie gives it. And Walker, carrying the ball, moves up just about the line of scrimmage, maybe a yard. One of the things that could be real troublesome for the Houston Gamblers today is when Walker does go up into that slot. It is Walker and Carthen, the setbacks, with Broughton moving up into a wide receiver position. He's very fast. Clarence Collins has been the prime receiver, and Sam Bowers the tight end. The big guys are Mackey, Stroh, Paul, Harris, and Maggs. Now you got Walker. As they shift again, Bowers coming to the near side, and as they shift, they go back into the I formation. And Walker again slants it off tackle, goes for a first down. He may go all the way. No flags, touchdown. That sort of reminds you of the play that he made against Baltimore when New Jersey had one play in the entire third quarter. It was an 80-yard touchdown run. This one goes for 88 yards, and it is the longest run in USFL history from scrimmage.
We told you about the injuries to the defensive line, about Herschel Walker taking on the corners. That man that just missed a tackle was number 24, Will Lewis, and then he just outran number 38, Derwood Ruckmore.
Ruzek for the extra point. Partridge on a low snap gets it down, and Ruzek knocks it through.
Walt Michaels is a coach who loves to run the football. Early parts of ball games over the last 3 weeks, he gives it to Herschel, finds out just what kind of mood Herschel Walker is in, whether he's going to take on people, or see what kind of game he's going to have. Right here, his second play from scrimmage, second time carrying the ball, Herschel Walker takes it all the way in for the touchdown. So you can look for Walt Michaels to continue running the football today.
9:39 to go in the first quarter, General 7-0. Well, it was billed as a showcase for Flutie and Kelly, but Herschel Walker, also a Heisman Trophy winner from Georgia, takes center stage off that 88-yard burst. Kelly's about to get the ball back, and we'll see whether or not he can respond with the Gamblers as Ruzek is ready to kick it off. Two plays that go 89 yards. One of them, the 88-yard sprint by Walker, and that's what it was once he got past the line of scrimmage. A very short, high kickoff taken in the middle by Sean Potts, who gives it now to Verdan. Verdan gets one block on the corner, but Terry Daniels coming across hustles him out of bounds. He's up around the 28-yard line before he is knocked out of bounds. He's got a fight on the field. We had offsetting personal fouls or unsportsmanlike conduct calls, so the ball remains in place, first down at the 26. It was turnovers last week that did the Gamblers in, though Kelly went for 393 yards. They produced only 14 points with all that yardage. So he's already had a turnover today on the interception by Preston. Todd Fowler now steps in as the running back. Richard Johnson goes in motion. And Kelly gives it to Todd Fowler. And Fowler is from the 26 to the 30 for about 4 yards on the carry. 20 about the New Jersey defense.
Well, the New Jersey defense, with all the people, they're still playing six. They're playing early with six defensive backs. They're planning on trying to come up, as we said earlier, be very physical with those receivers. You see the four down linemen on the line of scrimmage. Normally they play with three. They have not been effective yet at putting pressure on Jim Kelly.
Second down and six from the 30. Little swing out here to Johnson. Johnson tiptoes past the marker and will have a first down just beyond the 36. Now Herschel Walker with Tim Branch.
Herschel's gotten his breath back after that long run. Once you hit the corner, did you know you were going?
Well, I realized when I got outside, I figured that I had a good chance. I saw the strong safety had an angle on me, and I knew I could beat him outside.
Their defensive line's banged up. Are you going to try to test those corners a lot?
Well, not really test the corners. I think we're just going to go right at them. We're going to try to earn their respect, and I'll run the ball on them, and then we can pass it.
All right, Herschel. Keith?
Well, he's still got that speed, doesn't he? Once he got out there, it was long gone. They had the measurement and chains being run out as Kelly checks the list of plays on his. He's got one on the left wrist and one on the right wrist, so he's got a lot of options, I guess, but he double checks it that way, and the plays are signaled in from the sidelines.
I'll tell you a little bit more about how they do that, Keith, when we get a moment.
It is a first down just beyond the 36 of Houston. New Jersey leading 7-0. Still no pressure on Kelly. He waits a long time, hits Johnson with it, and once again, Richard Johnson makes a good catch. The ball was thrown behind him just a little bit. Ball's out in front. Might have been a different story there.
That's true. Now, Jack Pardee and his coaches will signal the plays in from the sideline, Keith, and he can pick them up very easily. But in order so that their signals aren't picked up by the defending team, so that they don't find out what those signals are, sometimes he will just signal a number. Then Kelly will look at the corresponding number on the wristbands and call that particular play.
He's 7 out of 10, 65 yards and the interception so far in the ball game. On second down and four, gives the ball to Fowler, and Fowler will have nothing more than a yard as he was really walloped by Bobby Leopold, the right outside linebacker.
Linebackers getting into the physical action of this ball game, jumping on Fowler right away.
Fowler has a future contract signed with the Dallas Cowboys. We understand the Los Angeles Raiders have been talking to Bobby Hebert of the Oakland Invaders, and Oakland last night was upset at Portland. Upset rather roundly, as a matter of fact, 30-17. It is third down and still close to 4 yards. Kelly's pass down the middle. Johnson's got it. And realizing that he was going to get hammered if he turned it upfield, and just coming off the injury list anyhow, he steps out of bounds near the 42 and has a first down on the New Jersey side of the field.
Well, that time they had the linebackers coming in, applying a little bit more pressure on the blitz, and it was man-to-man coverage downfield. But it's very accurate pass here by Kelly. You see Preston trying to go in front, knock the ball down. He took more of a chance than I think necessary, and Johnson running out of bounds to protect himself. I think we'll see more of the receivers, Keith, giving up a yard or two to protect himself in this ball game.
Ball is just short of the 41 on the New Jersey side. First down. Kelly, a little jumper out here to McGee, gets some help from the pulling lineman, and McGee gets 9 yards on the carry before he is brought down by John Joyce.
That was Dan Rosado, number 65, the right guard that had pulled out there. Looked like one of the players from New Jersey, a linebacker, may have shot through. Rosado was not able to pick him up. He was still out of the play, and Rosado was trying to lead up on the smaller cornerback.
Tuck on your socks, Joyce. Tuck on your socks.
It's got to be a lot of fun, though, for those small wide receivers to realize that they've got a big horse coming out of the trenches to help them downfield.
And just the opposite feeling for a cornerback who has to take
yeah,
them off.
That's right. Second down and one. Kelly's pass thrown low to Johnson. Johnson bobbled it. Question is, did he have possession? The mark appears to be yes, he did. First down at the 21.
We'll take another look at it, see what our replay camera shows if he picked it up. But just look at him driving downfield, a little move inside to throw Preston off. The ball is a little low because Kelly was under pressure, but right there you saw both hands just under the football, and he brings it up right away. By bringing the ball up that fast, he helps the official make the call on the play. But right now on the field, the red flag has been thrown, which means that Walt Michaels is challenging the call of the official.
It looked like a good catch to me. As he rolled over and started to get up, he dropped the ball. Walt says it hits the ground. So they will check with Ted Humphrey will check with the review official. And we've got an isolated look at it. So while they're making their decision, you have a look at it because they're looking at the same picture you are.
Now watch very carefully his hands as he goes down. Look at both hands under the ball right there. Now right there, it looks like a good catch. And I think the ruling official is going to rule it a good catch because it is not that clear-cut a call, Keith.
First down.
Yep.
The crowd boos. They're not happy with the call, neither is Walt Michaels. And he takes his challenge early in the ball game, and because the challenge was not successful, he now loses a timeout.
I don't know about the number of challenges made last night, if there were any, but that makes it something like 2 out of 16 for the year, I believe. The last 5 of 6 passes completed by Kelly have been thrown to Richard Johnson. He's running a little gingerly. He's still got a sore leg, so he's not going full bore. But it may loosen up as the day goes on. On first down from the 21, Kelly's pass, good. Right around the 5-yard line to Vince Corville as Corville came across and caught the ball right in front of Kerry Justin.
Keith, when you bring back a guy like Johnson into your lineup, he does a couple of things for you. Number one, you figure he's not playing unless he's healthy, so you have to watch him, pay close attention to him. Now, by Kelly hitting him early in the ball game like this, he's going to open up the rest of the field for his other receivers. Johnson himself, and I've been in this situation before with a pulled hamstring, will just glide through his patterns. He gets into the route, tries to come underneath the coverage, picks his spots to get open.
And it's first and goal to go for Houston, just short of the New Jersey 5-yard line. And Kelly puts it in the end zone, and it's incomplete. The ball was thrown behind Vince Corville a little bit that time as Bobby Leopold came pouring in on Jim Kelly, and the pressure on Kelly may have caused the pass to be off target.
Gregory Johnson, the safety, was also in on the play. I believe the receiver may have been open, but under the pressure, you see number 47, Joyce, coming to the inside. You see pressure coming from the outside as Kelly goes down, but the pass is just thrown in order to stop or to save a sack.
Well, the ball remains just short of the 5. Second down and goal to go for Houston. The Gamblers trying to tie it up here in the first quarter. And Kelly rolls out, gets it off very quickly. The little flip pass to Todd Fowler. A little shovel as Kelly was under extreme pressure that time, but they couldn't get the convoy working. They were trying to set up something of a screen pass, and it just didn't prove out.
Well, the problem, they were trying to set up a screen, but the problem in setting up the screen is you do have to delay the guys a little bit. Right here, 3 people come charging through. No one's delayed.
He's got people out. Armstrong wasn't even touched.
That's right. Now, Todd Fowler has people out in front of him, but because the ball didn't get to him, he had to come back. He bobbled it a little bit, finally got a hold of it. By the time he turned around, he was in the grasp of a tackle.
So it's 3rd and goal from the 3. There it is, touchdown, Clarence Verdan. They lined up double wide with McNeil and Verdan over there together, and McNeil went straight into the end zone to carry a defender with him. That gave Verdan single coverage, and he cut it to the goalpost, and Kelly hit him.
Well, Jim Kelly adjusting very well to the pressure that came upon him in this particular drive. You'll see it again. He gets a little pressure there, just flicks it off to his receiver right in front of Preston. Easy catch for the score.
Now Tony Fritsch, yes, the Tony Fritsch, 24 out of 25 on extra points. We'll try to tie it at 7 at 4:54 to play in the first quarter. Oh, he hit the upright, hit the left upright and missed it. I swear they must have the biggest uprights in all of football here at Giant Stadium because I have never in my life seen so many kicks hit the uprights as I have in this ballpark.
Well, the snap was good, the hold was good. It just goes wide to the left, hits that post. How many have we seen, Keith? 8 in this stadium alone?
I think so, because David Trout had 2 in one ball game here last year. It is 7-6 New Jersey. Dale Walters is in to kick off for Houston now. 7-6 New Jersey. Rod Pegues and Danny Knight are the deep people for the Generals. And Walters hooks it off to the left side and kicks it out of bounds. So he will back up 5 and kick it again, and he did not get a hole out of that ball. Tony Fritsch does not kick off. He kicks only the field goals and the points. And they use Walters because they feel Walters can kick the ball farther.
Now, let's tell the truth. The reason why Tony Fritsch does not kick off is because he has to run more than 3 yards to get to the ball. And he doesn't look like he wants to make the move.
Well, I guess the truth in this particular instance is apropos. I mean, as he said, he'd been playing soccer and doing this and doing that and so forth. And he felt he was he'd paid done his time, so he didn't want to get too exercised over it. New Jersey deciding that they will take the football, and so they will take it at the 30 rather than have them kick over. So they start out with good field position, leading by a point. The Generals taking the ball at the 30, first down. They lead 7-6 with 4:44 to go in the first quarter. Lutie sets Clarence Collins in motion. Now Carson and Bowers move, and they set up in the I formation, and looks like they're just going to keep hammering right at him. Walker went 88 yards for the New Jersey touchdown. This time he's hit behind the line of scrimmage on good penetration by number 97, Anthony Holyfield. Richard Johnson caught 4 passes in that touchdown drive by Houston. Here he is with Tim Brandt.
He also had that controversial catch. Were you surprised when they challenged it?
Yeah, I was, because I thought clearly my hands was up under the ball, and I knew I caught the ball. I came back to the huddle and told Jim, I said, don't worry about it. They're going to lose a timeout.
Looks like they're trying to intimidate you. It looks like some late hits.
Well, they have been late hitting us. You know, they're trying to intimidate us because we're small, but we're going to keep on fighting and keep on catching the ball. They can't do it.
All right, Keith.
Herschel Walker sweeps it right and runs into number 27. The strong safety, Luther Bradley. And Luther rode him out after a short gain of a couple of yards. Well, they don't give him that much. They put him out just about the marker.
Keith, that's an example of the kind of running that Walt Michaels would not like to see Herschel do. When it comes up to the line and it's clogged up, he should just keep going straight ahead to pick up whatever yards he can instead of just drifting to the outside.
Birmingham, leading the Eastern Conference at 5-1, is out to a 7-0 lead over San Antonio, a 33-0 winner over Portland last week. It's third down and call it about 9. Lutie still not going to the air, gives the ball to Herschel Walker, and Walker is cut down up around the 33-yard line. And good penetration that time by Kika Diala, the middle linebacker, number 31.
That's a very interesting call, third down and 9.
Are you on my way? Am I your way?
Running to the outside instead of going to the air. And Walt decides he wants to establish a ground attack. He does it apparently at all costs.
Rick Partridge is in to punt now. We've got a feature on Rick Partridge, who is one of the more traveled people in professional football, coming up for you at halftime. Rick hits it high, angles it for the sidelines, and Gerald McNeil coming across makes the catch at the 32-yard line. It was a 35-yard punt. The Gamblers will have it first down at their own 32. 3:06 to go, first quarter. All right, here come the Gamblers now on first down from the 32 with Sam Hurrell lined up in the backfield. And Kelly, a little quick pop to Johnson. And Johnson is very quickly out to the 40 and up to the 41 for a 9-yard pickup on the play. Armstrong and Joyce were there to bring him down.
You see Johnson getting up laughing. I think he's laughing more at the fact that as soon as he caught that pass, he realized he was going to have to take on 2 people and just lay down on the ground and protect himself. Had he not injured himself, if he were at full strength, I think he would have just turned on the afterburners and tried to outrun the tackle.
Second down, a little more than a yard as Todd Fowler comes in now for Harrell. Fowler has it. Kelly fell down as he was handing the ball off to Fowler. And Todd is up close to a first down. And again, it depends on the mark, but it looks to me like it's out beyond the 42. Fowler hurt, of course, in the exhibition game, preseason game, just before the season started against Birmingham. And he played for the first time last week. He's carried the ball only 10 times so far. And he does have the first down squarely on the 42. 2 minutes to go in the first quarter. 7-6, Generals lead. Kelly steps away from the pressure, tries to turn it upfield, but looping in is Emmanuel Weaver out of South Carolina, 6'4", 280. And Weaver getting some playing time with the injury to Tom Woodland at the nose guard spot, and he just slid right on in there and got his man.
He did a real good job. You'll see the outside pressure coming up facing Kelly. He ducks inside of it. That's Lockett on the outside, number 96, forcing him inside. But Weaver just scrapes across the line of scrimmage to make the tackle.
The offensive people on the New Jersey side talking. Chris Palmer, the quarterback coach there. Got six defensive backs in the ball game now for New Jersey as Kelly gives the ball to Fowler. And Fowler, with his head down, banging off people, moves the ball to about the 40, close to the 49.
That's the sixth running play, and it's only the first quarter. However, 54 seconds and counting left to play. And that's an inordinate number of times for the Houston Gamblers to run the football. You know? And look at, of course, you look at it compared to the passing plays, and passing still dominant in their ball game, their game plan. But yet, running the ball six times in the first quarter is high for this team.
Third down and four. Kelly tried to dump it off into the middle and again set up that inside screen pass to his running back Fowler. But New Jersey had jumbled things up sufficiently and he had no chance to get to it, and he had to get rid of it because Jim Byrne was all over him. And now Dale Walters is in to punt on fourth and four. And going back is Danny Knight for New Jersey. Walters just over 40 yards per kick. Wind swirls around inside this bowl. That's not a very good kick. And he knocks it out of bounds around the 23-yard line. So foul. Walters didn't get a whole lot of it. But he denied Knight a chance to return it, only 27 yards on the punt. 20 seconds to go in the first quarter. New Jersey with the ball. And they have given the mark at the 24-yard line.
Jack Pardee does not want to have to win this game with his defense. A major portion of his game plan is for offense to score and score big. The defense will be severely tested if the offense doesn't get it cranked up.
Walker and Herschel stacks in the middle and gets a couple of 3 yards out of it. Kika Diella, the middle linebacker, is in the bottom of the stack as he looks to me like is hunting Herschel today. And time now ticking off at the end of the first quarter of play. And after one at Giant Stadium in the Meadowlands, New Jersey, the New Jersey Generals lead the Houston Gamblers by 1-7-6. Well, every New Jersey play so far in the ball game has been a run by Herschel Walker. Six plays, 96 yards, 88-yard touchdown run in that six carries. It is now second down and 7. The ball is at the 28 of the Generals. They lead 7-6. And Walker's got it again. And he's a couple of yards short of the first down.
Take a look at the stats. You'll notice time of possession at the bottom right away. Houston is normally not the possession team. It's usually the kind of statistic you'd associate with the New Jersey Generals. You see there, no yards passing, no passes being thrown, passing dominating the statistics for the Houston Gamblers. And when you look at turnovers, that one turnover might as well put an equal sign to the 90, at least to 88, 89 yards to the 96 of the New Jersey Generals, because it was 89 yards and two plays that the general scored after taking away a pass from Jim Kelly.
Third down and 2. Second clock ran out on him. So it'll be third down and 7.
number 22.
I think now we may see the first pass.
Could be. Could I thought be. We'd see it while it go on third and eight.
third and eight, but they didn't.
The referee, Ted Humphrey, is so hoarse. He can barely talk. He probably ought to be home in bed. Blue spring pole. Right, third down and seven now. Ball comes back near the 28. Nope, they give it to Walker and he breaks it out of there. They trap in the middle. Herschel has a hole. You could have driven a truck through and he picks up a first down as he goes near the 41.
Excellent play call, and still not a single pass having been thrown so far by Doug Flutie. Man-to-man coverage. They have run the quick draw up the middle. That's eight carries now for Herschel Walker, and get this, 111 yards.
He certainly had a lot of room to roam that time. Where were the linebackers?
Covering receivers.
From the 41, Flutie bootlegs it out. First pass is good to Bowers. And Sam has a first down on the Houston side of the field, and a penalty flag is thrown.
Stop by Lewis.
Might wipe that one out.
They were 73 illegally downfield, loss of down.
That gets a grumble out of Walt, and I don't blame him, because they had a big play. They had a first down on the Houston side of the field, and it's wiped out.
Doug Mackey, the left tackle from Ohio State. I believe, Keith, that may be the first time, at least in the games we've covered, and we've covered five in the last 7 weeks, that an offensive lineman has been called for being an illegal receiver downfield. And it's unusual because the amount of scrambling that Doug Flutie has done.
The ball comes back to the 31. They've got to go to the Houston 49 to get the first down. The Generals have been flagged four times for a total of 35 yards.
425!
Herschel Walker with it. And Walker runs over Mackey just as Doug was starting to get up from the initial block. And it takes Walker's legs from under him, and so it'll bring up fourth down and very long, and obviously a punting circumstance.
Keith, when you think about instinctive runners, when you think about people who just don't think about where they're going, they come up and they feel it. You're talking about guys like Joe Cribbs and Kelvin Bryant. That time, had Herschel Walker run more instinctively, he would have bounced quickly to his right and had more running room.
They need the big play here, otherwise they're forced into a situation that could give Houston field position, and it's Flutie diving for the marker. And Flutie takes it upfield for the first down at the Houston 45-yard line. Will Lewis was one of those, along with Andy Hawkins, that had a shot at him, and they missed him.
Now take a look at this. He can't find his receiver. He takes off to run. He's going to see the marker and then give number 59, Andy Hawkins, a little move to the outside, or Will Lewis, a move to the outside, and then cut inside to pick up the necessary 2 yards for the first down.
So Flutie does it himself on third and very long, just when everybody was thinking that Houston might get the ball back. They go back to Herschel Walker, and that's Maurice Carthen getting his first carry. And Carthen finding some room to run, so the New Jersey game plan to run straight at Houston looks to me to be a very sound game plan.
Well, Herschel Walker said he wanted to gain respect. I think more they just want to inflict some punishment on that defensive line. The Houston Gamblers have come into this ball game with an injury-riddled defensive line, and today they only have five defensive linemen, one backup for all four of those men who are down there playing right now.
Carthen got 8 yards, second down and two, and Flutie rolls out. He had Broughton open, but now the pressure, and he throws it away, throwing it out of bounds. Kika Diella came in and knocked Flutie down, but well after he had, the ball was gone, but no flag on the play. Kiki really didn't lay one on him. He just sort of fell down with him to take away the shot. He had Broughton early, as Broughton was running a deep corner route, and Doug just simply couldn't set himself to throw the ball that far. It'll be third down and two.
Keith, I think they'll run the football.
Somebody has something thrown out on the field, some object. It's like a ball of some kind.
A tennis ball.
Yeah.
Oh, good, I could use one of those. I've used several of those in where I play tennis.
Let's go. Let's go, man. Pick it up.
But they've got the short yardage defensive alignment, including Chris Ream in the lineup now for Houston. And give the ball to Walker. And he didn't get there. Number 31, Viella. And the big man at the bottom is number 35, Mike Mitchell, the corner.
It was number 97, Anthony Holyfield, and number 50, Ricky Young, who both penetrated in that charge upfield to cause Herschel Walker to stumble and not be able to get back to the line of scrimmage. But right now it's fourth down and the offense is still in the ballgame.
Fourth and two, they're going.
70's eligible.
Flutie trips a little bit, coming off the snap, but Doug's got the first down as he dives inside the 35 to the 34.
The only receiver he had on that play was his tight end, 81, Jeff Speck, who had come around from the top, from the far left in that formation on the crossing pattern. But I think Doug had run all the way on his mind, all the way on this particular play. You see him looking upfield, seeing a little hole, and a little munchkin from Boston squeezes through.
It was interesting that John Jewell, number 70, a tackle, had lined with that alignment. They had declared him as an eligible receiver, and he was an eligible receiver on that play, a tackle eligible, if you will. First down from the 34. It's Walker again. And Herschel gets down around the 30 for a four-yard pickup before Viella and Hawkins bring him down. 10 minutes to go in the first half, and a 7-6 ball game. New Jersey leading and driving right now.
This is one of those games, Keith, when a coach says keep your head on the swivel so you can always look around and see where people are and where people are coming from. You better have it on that swivel this afternoon, because there are people on both sides who are just looking for a body, standing around doing nothing to put them on the ground.
Flutie still got it. Wants to go deep. Has a man short. Collins makes the catch at the 9. First and goal, New Jersey at the Houston 9. Well, the New Jersey Generals offensive front gave Flutie all day that time.
He just rolled out and waited, and you saw that little sidearm flick. But watch him when he throws this pass. He doesn't come over the head. Classic quarterback style. He just kind of flicks on the side right there, falling away from it. Collins is wide open, but he was pinned up on the sideline. Sure, he would rather have been able to stop, cut back to the inside, give it a little bit more of an effort for the touchdown.
First and goal for the Generals. Houston 9. Walker. And he's near the 5. Well, we said last week, again, the Baltimore win over Houston, the best way to beat them is get some points on the board and keep the ball doing it. Keep that Houston offense on the bench. And New Jersey's doing it here in the second quarter. Overcoming a 10-yard penalty as well.
That's after Herschel shocked him with his second carry of the game.
From the 6, it's Carthen. And Maurice is to about the 3 before he is dragged back. Cleveland Crosby, number 78, was the man that stacked in the middle and made the tackle on Carthen, the principal tackle on him. The ball just short of the 3. Carthen off the field now, leaving Harmon in the backfield with Herschel walking out. Clarence Harmon, number 38, who moves up into a slot. If they run, they'll surely go right because everybody's over there. Now found a hole in the middle, and he's close to the goal line. Andy Hawkins kept him out of the end zone. Herschel apparently had the privilege of reading on that play, and he chose to run behind the center, Kent Hall, and he's about a foot short of the goal line.
Gerwood Rockmore, number 38, was a free safety. And just watch how Herschel hits him, almost knocking him into the end zone. First it's Hawkins. But Gerwood is standing back at the line. He just pops him a little bit, drives him into the end zone.
Fourth down. Walker, touchdown. Herschel Walker behind Stroth, Mackey, and Hull goes the left side and gets the touchdown. At 7:38 to go in the first half. So Herschel's got two TDs today.
The record for most yards in the game is held by a man who's playing here this afternoon, Todd Fowler, with 208. Second is also a Houston gambler, Sam Harrell, with 200. Herschel Walker may be fast approaching that this afternoon.
Ruzek nails the extra point, and it's now a 14-6 ball game, and Herschel Walker with 14 carries, 124 yards, and two touchdowns.
Maybe it's taken 3 years, Keith, but Herschel Walker, a number of the games we've seen, is now finally starting to run like the Heisman Trophy player that we saw back at Georgia. We'll be back. Score 14-6.
That's the kind of scoring drive that gladdens the heart of the Generals coach, Walt Michaels.
You got the ball and you control it for 77 minutes and 42 seconds and you score. It's key, and you know everything is working in your favor, and it starts to grind on the Houston offense not to have an opportunity to be on the field.
Ruzek, a very high deep kick, and it will go to Calvin Eason at the goal line. And Eason is cut down around the 16. And we've got a ruckus going on down on the field again.
There's a penalty flag.
Yep, we do.
Laying between the 40 and the 35-yard line. Well in front of the little scrape that was going on.
Seems like every time we have a kick in this ball game, we have a fight of some kind.
That's because the ball players don't think anybody's watching what they're doing.
Illegal block, bumper waste, number 50, first down.
So it's against the Houston Gamblers. They didn't have very good field position off that kick return in the first place, out only to the 16. And now Ricky Young is nailed with an illegal block, and that moves him back inside the 10 to the 8.
A number of years ago.
7:29 to go, and the Gamblers will go to work on their own 8. I think those stats right there reflect amply the general character of the offense of these two teams. But right now, the runners are leading 14-6. Kelly ducks away from the pressure, going to run it. John Joyce is waiting on him, but Kelly gets out of bounds. And he gets a first down. Jim ran it up just over the 20. Joyce had a chance over there. John could have nailed him, but he saw that out of bounds mark, and he let him go.
Well, John's not a dumb player. I mean, he wanted to get Kelly, but he realized if he went for the same kind of little move that Doug Flutie gave Lewis earlier in the ball game, Kelly could have ducked up inside and picked up another 10 or 15 yards. So he held his position, forced him with the angle to the outside, and just tried to make the tackle just before he stepped out of bounds, but missed him.
That's what he could do if he stays on his current pace. Jim Kelly. On the first down snap, sets up the throw, goes short to Richard Johnson, trying to cut back, loses his footing, and then by that time Bobby Leopold had him. He's short of his first down. He picked up about 5 yards or so up near the 26.
That little quick move was a sign of more confidence on his part as far as his leg is concerned. When the injured ball player steps onto the field with a leg injury, he, as Johnson has, is very careful, very cautious until he starts to feel confident. Then they start making the fast moves.
San Antonio making a game of it with the Birmingham Stallions, now 7-6. The Stallions lead with McGee and Johnson coming out. And Bruce goes in motion. Kelly wings it over to Gerald McNeil, comes back into the middle. And his 140 pounds doesn't carry him very far. He's right about the line of scrimmage. He couldn't make his cut in time to split him, and by that time, Fitzgerald, who literally weighs 140 pounds, just disappeared.
Well, you give him a little star for having the courage to go inside like that. That little screen play is set up to have blocking come from the inside out so that you should step inside to pick up that block and then cut up field. But the New Jersey Generals strung out the young man from Baylor where he couldn't cut up field.
He did get two, so it'll be third down and about three. Ball at the 28 of Houston. Kelly throws, he chose Johnson. He had Verdan, but he chose Richard Johnson, and the pass is a little behind him and Gregory Johnson defending on the play. And so they come up and miss on their third and three, and now Walters has got to punt it.
Number 32, Kenny Johnson, had a few words, I think, for Johnson on that play also. Running conversation between the receivers. The receivers from Houston are a bit vocal, Keith, so there might be some hot tempers and some hot words throughout the afternoon.
Dale Walters' first punt today was a 27-yarder. Blocked! Number 27 comes flying in to block it. Gregory Johnson, it goes to the end zone. It's touchdown, New Jersey. Maurice Clemens, number 59, a linebacker.
I believe it was number 27. Gregory Johnson, who came in, blocked the punt of Walters. I don't think Walters had any idea that Johnson was on his way because he took all of the time in the world trying to set up on this punt.
He looks a bit stunned, and it's a 20-6 lead for the New Jersey Generals as Rizek tries to add the point here out of Partridge Hole. Good. Watch number 27 now. Gregory Johnson just come flying through there.
He'll come from the left of your screen, right through the middle. It created a gap by sending people upfield. Johnson just came up through the middle, blocked it. The ball is knocked in the end zone with number 59, Maurice Clemens, the left inside linebacker, is there to fall on it for the touchdown. But take a look at Walters. He doesn't sense the pressure. He gets a ball, taking three steps to make this putt, and it's way too late. A very clean block. Then he takes a hit from number 75, Frank Mattias.
So, the Gamblers, having lost last week, trailing here 21-6. Well, as we mentioned at the very outset of the telecast today, you want to be careful if you can possibly manage to get all the adrenaline going. Once you've suffered your first loss, look out, because it's pretty dadgum easy with the balance of the league now to lose two or three.
And especially having so many people hurt, and you can justify not playing at your best because you've got key personnel out, it's easy to get down and stay down.
High hanging kickoff for Dan at the 10. Oh, he's dangerous, isn't he? Comes out to about the 35 before he is brought down. Now with 5:16 to go in the first half, the Gamblers will try to get something going. A contemplative Jim Kelly now, as he has been roughed up some by the New Jersey Generals. And right now, I would say that Walt Michaels is going to be very happy because everything is going just the way he likes it. He's got a 21-6 lead. His offense is beginning to control the football. They have blunted Houston's last two possessions. Johnson is outside. Johnson has a first down for the Gamblers as they give him a little room, and he's up to about the 48. Now, why in the world is Richard Johnson getting open so much when the people who played that position last week and in the starting series today had so much trouble getting loose?
Well, the reason why it's getting open is that with four men rushing, the secondary linebackers are playing predominantly zone coverages, and that's what the Generals normally play in their secondary. With all the crossing of the receivers, it's the people who come underneath in the short routes that are going to break open. And that right now is Johnson.
Johnson has eight catches for 82 yards. Kelly's pass is away. Verdan takes a hard hit from Jerry Holmes, but holds on to the ball. And he's down at the 37 of New Jersey.
But Verdan was in the air, and we'll take a look at that zone. Watch it as it spreads out and gains depth, and the receiver's crossing through the zone to the outside, and you see right there, 25. Preston turns inside, creating the gap right there. Jerry Holmes was deep in the zone. Now, this is a good hit, but because Verdan is in the air, he doesn't feel it as much as if he were on the ground and stationary. His body just goes with the force of the hit.
Kelly back on first down. Loops it in the air for McNeil, and he's out of bounds. Incomplete forward pass.
That was Jerry Holmes on the coverage.
McNeil is giving away. Holmes is 6'3". McNeil is 5'8". So there's a 5-inch differential there. And even though McNeil had a step and a half on Holmes, the ball hung up there, and Jerry got back into his face, and now he comes down with 1 foot
in
bounds.
He's clearly out of bounds, but if he were a bigger receiver, Keith, he would have gone up earlier for this pass. He would have gone up about right there, a little bit higher and stronger, to make that catch and get that foot in bounds. But there was a penalty flag on the play, too, Keith. It looks like it's being marked off against the New Jersey Generals.
And that will be good for a Houston first down. Well, they're playing rough. The roughness call very much in evidence today. As the time remaining, just over 4 minutes to go. The ball now moves to the 22 of New Jersey. First down, Houston. Kelly, a lot of time and a lot of room to run. And he runs for the marker and gets out of bounds without taking a blow. And they've marked him out down near the 11-yard line, and that'll be another first down for the Gamblers.
Number 90, Freddie Gilbert, was a man who was chasing him from behind. You see here, he's getting good protection. The entire pocket has collapsed. Sprints to the outside. Big Freddie Gilbert trying to turn on the jets and catch up to him. But Kelly, not the fastest man in the world, but fast enough to outrun number 90.
Gilbert, though, is pretty quick for his size.
Oh, yes, he is.
Yardage McGee, yeah. And Purville wide. Johnson in motion. From the 11. Little flip is good to Verdan. Verdan is taken down inside the 5. And they'll put him out at the 4, brought down by Kerry Justin.
Number 26, Kerry Justin. And again, you saw number 25, John Preston, after Verdan had caught the pass. And Kerry Justin grabbed him about the ankles, about to go down. He came over to hit him again. And he was very close, Keith, to being out of bounds when that hit was made. Now, you don't want to give these receivers too much of an edge and sideline some room to turn it up on you. But right here, he's on the sideline. He's going down and out of bounds. Again, they're coming in with the hits almost late.
Ball is on the 3, second down. And they can get a first down without scoring. Penalty flag down. The ball is intercepted by number 75, Frank Mattias, the nose tackle, and Kelly is hurt on the play for a moment. Now he gets up and walks away, but let's see about all the flags on the field.
It may have been a motion penalty, Keith. I'm not sure.
I think the field judge threw his early.
Well, there are two flags. One's in the end zone, and one's at about the 8-yard line.
Ed Humphrey sorting it out. Here's the call.
Illegal motion, offense, holding, defense, and it is declared.
Whoa. What a big break for Jim Kelly and the offense of the Houston Gamblers.
He took a pretty good lick. He was slow getting up. I'm not sure whether it was out of disgust of having the ball picked off or whether somebody really nailed him. Let's see here.
I'd rather have the physical look. You see the ball is tipped by Freddie Gilbert, and then number 75, Frank Mattias, comes over and picks it up.
Oh,
he just rolls over Jim Kelly.
Kelly got mashed.
I'd take the hit before I'd want to take another interception at this point in the ballgame.
So it's second down from the 3 again. As the Gamblers get a break. Kelly shoots it, and it is incomplete, thrown low in the end zone, and Kelly took a vicious lick from Gilbert. And he's very slow getting up, and it looks like Kelly has re-injured the left knee. He wears a brace on that knee, and he's walking very gingerly with it, flexing it now, and comes back to the huddle. So apparently he's all right.
We'll take a look. Freddie Gilbert will come from the top of the screen, around the outside. Number 96, James Lockett, will come from the outside and make that hit on Kelly. While Freddie Gilbert has him around the leg.
So he got high load. It is third down, about a yard and a half for a first down. Ball is near the three. Pass is incomplete. McNeil is yelling that he was interfered with, but no flag, and it brings up fourth down and brings in Tony Fritsch. And so the New Jersey defense now has got to take some heart with it, as they have held the Houston Gamblers down inside the 20-yard line.
Well, see, Kelly just set up and really fired this one in there, threw this about as hard as you wanted to, but Jerry Holmes, number 37, had the inside position and was able to step in front of it.
So Tony Fritsch is in now for a 19-yard field goal try. Jack Pardee wants something out of this possession. 3:16 to go in the first half. Fritsch missed an extra point earlier, but he hits the field goal in the middle. So with 3:12 to go in the first half, it is now New Jersey 21 and the Houston Gamblers 9. So Tony has somewhat redeemed himself after missing that extra point. But I think it's, as I said, heartening for the New Jersey Generals defensive unit, because they hung in there and they made them settle for a field goal instead of the touchdown.
Well, you see them there on the sidelines clapping, excited, as if they scored the touchdown or had a tremendous goal line stand where they came away without giving any points away.
Rod Pegues and Danny Knight are the deep people as Dale Walters gets ready to kick it off. 21-9, New Jersey. And we'll see whether or not the Generals can run out the clock or whether Houston can force him to punt the ball away. Pegues from the 5, and Rod comes back to the 24, where he is taken down hard. So now let's see if Walt Michaels and company decides to change gears a little bit now. It's been pretty much the Herschel Walker show so far.
I don't think he will, Keith. There's 3 minutes and 4 seconds to play in the second quarter. The running game has been outstanding for him. The more he pounds at the defensive line of the Houston Gambler, the more I think he feels he wears them down with only one backup for all four of the guys who are out there now.
Carthen. And the big back booming in there for about 8 yards. Frustrated Jim Kelly right now with Tim Brandt.
Jim, the big question is, how's the knee?
Oh, that's great. I just got a little hit on it, but it's all right.
Seems like there's an awful lot of talking going on between the offense and the defense out there.
That's them, not me. I'll tell you what, the offense line, it's always like that. I don't even worry about it.
Giving you a lot of man. Any particular problems?
No problems. We just got a good thing in the end zone, just like last week. We just have to capitalize on it.
Okay, Jim. Pete.
Second down and one as Carthen came up with 9. Walker has the first down as Herschel fights his way to the 38. Now 2 minutes to go in the first half. The New Jersey Generals, a commanding 12-point margin, 21-9, with 2 minutes to go in the first half. Like I said, it's been the Herschel Walker show. 129 out of the 173 running yards for the New Jersey Generals. Houston, on the other hand, has 173 yards in passing. You see, there's quite a crowd on the field here at Giant Stadium. Throw from one side to the other, Kelly might lose sight of some of those short receivers. Doug Flutie gives it to Carthen, and Carthen finds a hole, and he pounds in there for close to 5 yards before Van Hughes gets him.
He had Strolk, Mackey, and Sam Bowers all blocking to the outside. But Maurice Carthen saw a hole open up to the inside and said, why waste time running from side to side? Let's get upfield and get it done.
Yellow, yellow!
He is a tough north-south runner. Herschel Walker this time. And he breaks tackles and picks up a first down. At the Houston 49, New Jersey, with 2 timeouts remaining, they lost one on the challenge when they challenged a reception, and the reception was ruled good.
It looked like one, looked like a little billiard ball there, bouncing off from side to side, off players.
Well, that was Cleveland Crosby, the first one, He's 250 pounds.
Now there's Michaels. You see the crowd in the field. That camera is on the ground on the far side. Cuts him off from the waist down.
Carthen, a little delay up the middle. And he just keeps on rumbling close to the 40-yard line. So they'll need about a yard and a half for another first down. And now New Jersey will call a timeout with 59 seconds to play in the first half. And they realize they're now getting close enough to get some points out of this.
A 1-2 punch of Carthen and Herschel Walker is going to be devastating to this defensive line throughout the afternoon.
Well, they come back very quickly. So I guess they indicated a timeout, but they didn't take it as well. Herschel booms in there again to the 31, and the clock stops now with 42 seconds to play in the first half as they pick up another first down.
And now they call a timeout.
Now they spin the timeout. So New Jersey with one timeout remaining and 42 seconds to work with. With the first down at the Houston 31, Doug Flutie had a long conversation with Chris Palmer. He is almost personal tutor in professional football. And with 42 seconds to go now, they may go to the pass here. If they can get 28 points in this first half, they'll be in pretty good shape. They send Walker wide. And they will put it up. Go short with it to Carthen out of the backfield, and Carthen's second effort, dragging a man with him, is close to the first down. Clock is still ticking along, coming down to 20 seconds. They come without a huddle. It's a yard short of his first down. And Flutie quickly to the air. Throws it away. Walter Broughton was over there, well covered by Will Lewis. And Flutie threw it into the crowd. And that stops the clock with 13 seconds. So they've got one timeout remaining. If they need it, Flutie quickly to the sidelines to get the play here. Now the 30-second clock starts to roll. 21-9.
Here's a general Easter Bunny. Right now, what they want to find on the football field is not an egg, but a touchdown.
They want to lay an egg. Flutie goes to the corner. Broughton got turned around. He stopped short, and Flutie pumped it and tried to send him to the end zone, and he got tangled up with Will Lewis and couldn't get there. Begs the official a bit, but gets no call, and that'll bring Ruzek into the lineup for the field goal try. 8 seconds to go in the first half.
Okay, I think they were a bit confused when the clock had about 20 seconds on it. I thought they had called a timeout. They didn't. The clock was running, so Flutie came back on the field very quickly to throw a pass to stop the clock, to give them a chance to go for the field goal here.
39-yard try. It will, if it is successful, be his longest of the year. But plenty of leg on it, and he got it. So a 39-yarder, his longest of the season, leaves three ticks on the clock and makes the score New Jersey 24 and Houston 9. Well, I would think that Walt Michaels and company have got to be satisfied with this, setting with a 24-9 lead and the way they've been able to control the ball. But true, Houston's explosive.
No way. Just go back to the first game of the year when they were trailing by three touchdowns to the LA Express and they came back. Of course, they had most of their people in the ball game and healthy. Doug Flutie does not want to sit on this lead because he knows his counterpart, Jim Kelly, is on the sideline just waiting for a chance to get back at the football and put the points on the scoreboard.
Verdan will be the man in the middle. And Calvin Eason now has come up the field, which gives Verdan the room to roam back there. They absolutely want him to have the ball, but I wouldn't be surprised to see Ruzek probably kick it on the ground.
I tell him to kick it to Verdan, and everybody hustle down that field and get a lick on him with 3 seconds going in the ball game. How can you lose even if you do throw a flag?
He kicks the low one, and it's finally picked up by Sean Potts. And Potts comes back across the 36, and the first half is over. So the New Jersey Generals grinding it out, making the running game work against Houston, leads 24-9. We'll be back with the halftime activities after this message and the word from our local station. Quick look at some of the highlights of the first half in the main, a headbutt and grind them out thing for New Jersey that's put them in good position.
It's kind of a football game that the big people want to take control of and the little people want to find a place to hide and save themselves.
The first real big play of the game was a John Preston interception, and it followed one play after that by Herschel Walker as he turns the corner, goes 88 yards.
Well, he took the ball straight up the middle. There was nothing there, and he bounced untouched to the outside where it became a foot race between him and the clock, really.
The longest scrimmage scoring play in USFL history, 88 yards. So that made it 7-0, and then Houston comes right back as Kelly throws to Clarence Ferdinand, 4 yards, touchdown, but Tony Fritsch hits the upright and misses the extra point to make it 7-6 in the first quarter. In the second quarter, Herschel Walker again.
A 1 yard run, a good drive by the New Jersey Generals who just took control of this drive. It took 7 minutes and 42 seconds for them to march 75 yards in about 17 plays to establish their ball control and dominance in the first half.
That made it 14-6. Then the block punt by Gregory Johnson as he comes flashing in, gets a clean block on Dale Walters there. The ball caroms away from the pursuers, eventually going into the end zone where Maurice Clemens covers it for the touchdown, and that made it 21-6. And then Tony Fritsch kicked a field goal to make it 21-9, and then the field goal by Ruzek makes it 24-9 halftime.
Classic case, Keith, of the old versus the new, the run versus the pass, the radical versus the conservative, and the conservative guys are winning. Walt Michaels just possessing the football, using his two big running backs to establish the flow of the ball game, and then coming to Doug Flutie later on in the ball game with a few short passes.
So that means that the Houston Gamblers, beat up as they are on defense, probably going to have to do some gambling on the defensive side of the ball now.
They're going to have to, and I don't know how much they can afford to gamble. Again, they only have 5 defensive linemen in this ball game. On short yardage situations, they bring in an offensive tackle to fill in the gaps for their hurt defensive line.
So they're in trouble. They lost last week, and they don't shape up and get something rolling here, they're going to lose their second in a row. So we'll be back with the third quarter after this message and a word from our local station.
Walters will kick off to start the second half.
So Walt Michaels, New Jersey Generals, out in front 24-9 as we get ready to go to the second half of play. Houston kicking off to the Generals, and the pressure now is on the Houston defense to take the ball away from New Jersey. Don't let them sit on it for 6 or 7 minutes. Pegues comes up the middle with a kickoff return to about the 27-yard line. So the Generals will send out Doug Flutie and his cohorts on offense as we look at the halftime numbers.
As we look at the halftime stats, they're fairly even in total yardage, and they've acquired them in the ways that we expected their teams to acquire them. The rushing yardage for the Generals and the passing yardage for the Houston Gamblers. And it's the Gamblers who have turned the ball over, made the one missed critical error that resulted in a touchdown for the New Jersey Generals as Herschel Walker took the second play from scrimmage for an 88-yard touchdown. And there is an injured New Jersey General player down on the field
as a
result of the kickoff, and that is Rod Pegues.
He was twisted as he was hit. Somebody had his feet locked, legs locked, and then somebody else whacked him high, and they sort of spun him around as he went down hard, and he's hurt on the play. Again, recapping some of the scores, Orlando getting its first win of the year, beating Memphis, and Memphis has got to go on the road to Baltimore and play the Stars next week. But I was really startled at the 30-17 victory of Portland over Oakland last night. Let's have another look at the kickoff return, and you'll see the blow that is laid on Pegues. He trips there. Now he is twisting as he goes down, and a couple of people hit him. But he's up now, and he's going to walk off the field on his own.
I think when he had his head lowered there a little bit, he took that shot in the back, kind of wrenched his neck a little bit. You see him there, twisting his head, adjusting his back.
One of his teammates accusing him of getting a little TV time. A lot of sympathy over there. Well, Tom, let's call it the 28. Just outside the 27. as Flutie now will take the snap from Kent Hall, and the Gunners will start to work here in the second half. We'll go back to Herschel Walker. Walker splits it over the left side and comes out to the 31. That'll leave him out to the 37. That'll leave him a couple of yards short of his first down.
And he picked up a good low block from Sam Bowers to cut inside before he was brought down by Mike Hawkins. He's having quite a day. That was his 18th carry on the day. But at the end of the first half, he had 17 carries for 147 and two touchdowns. Now it's 155.
Rolling up the yardage on the ground. This ball is put down at the 36, where it's second down. About a yard and a half. Walker again. Earning his money today. They pin him up on the side, and they'll throw him for a loss short of the 35-yard line.
They're saying it was a fumble on the play. The coaches, players pointing. Number 68, Lloyd Lewis, is pointing towards the goal line, saying that the gamblers have recovered the fumble. I didn't even see it, Keith.
And it just sort of disappeared in that crowd. Everybody was clutching and grabbing at it. That's Lewis coming out to say Houston's got it. But let's wait for the man with a striped shirt. I think they're still wrestling over it.
Or at least one of them. At this point, I think I'd be afraid to say anything. The official's trying to pull players off. Tried to pull Andy Hawkins off. Andy Hawkins almost turned around and hit him back.
Well, it's Houston's ball. It took them forever to get him unwound.
They're right there on the general sideline, and Walt Michaels didn't seem to be contesting the call too much. Number 31, Kiki Diallo, the man jumping up and down. Let's take another look. Herschel Walker's got the ball. Let's try and figure out where it comes loose. 27 is Luther Bradley right there. He reaches in, strips him of the ball. And after that, it's your guess as good as mine as to who recovered it.
Well, Diallo gets official credit for the recovery, so it is Houston's ball, and there is a big break for them.
Well, the ball's just resting on the gambler's chest before he realized it was there.
And on first down from the 34, Kelly's pass is away into the end zone, and McNeil can't quite run it down. Jerry Holmes running with him, and McNeil is the fellow who likes track meets, and he had a half a step, but Holmes keeping up with him pretty well and give Jerry the edge in size again, a 5-inch difference in favor of the defender.
Now watch how difficult it is for McNeil to judge his ball, to really see it coming. It's got to come over the shoulder of Holmes and McNeil. Then he's got to try and judge it to see if he can stretch out and get it or dive for it. That one just dropped right in front of him. He didn't have much of a chance.
So it's second down and 10, Houston at the New Jersey 34. They pop one in the end zone here. We'll have a ball game. It's Verdan. Verdan's got a first down. He ran him, pushed that defender downfield, and then whirled in front of Terry Daniels, and boom, the ball was there, and he came up with it.
He's just running a quick out pattern down the field. He's got someone clearing out for him. It's man-to-man coverage. You see, he gets Terry Daniels on the inside. All he has to do is just make a good cut and break away from him. The timing on the play is good. The ball is there. He picks up the first down.
Ball is just inside the 18 of New Jersey. Kerry Justin, injured slightly, out for the moment. Kelly getting pressure, Lockett sets him. Lockett looping from the outside. He's been trying to come from there all day long, and he finally got him. And Kelly is hurt.
He came right over, number 70, Tommy Robinson. And Kelly is hurt.
Holding the wrist.
Grabbing his right wrist. James Lockett. Today is his 25th birthday, and on that birthday, he may have put Jim Kelly out of the ball game.
Kelly had the ball in his right hand when he went down. Oh, could it be a broken wrist?
Let's watch it. You see Kelly looking to his left. He doesn't see Lockett. Lockett just brings him in, and then it's Gilbert who's coming in from the other side, and they sandwich it.
Hand was wrapped around the football as Lockett came in and hit him hard and took him down, and the injury is to the right. Todd Dillon warming up in a hurry. Jim Kelly being taken to the clubhouse now, obviously for examination and probable x-rays, and it clearly looks as if that wrist might be broken. He's really in pain, And that gets Todd Dillon into the quarterback position for the Houston Gamblers on second down and about 17. Dillon has not played much. Stands up quick, little wing out to McNeil. McNeil breaks it. Going to the corner, and he's shoved out of bounds on the one-yard line. So Dillon comes in and gets a confidence builder right off the bat.
And he's happy about that.
Another look at Kelly's injury. Lockett looping in from the defensive end position. Kelly carrying the ball in the right hand. Gilbert comes across and hits him as well, but it looked that Lockett's weight as he went down, Kelly's hand on the ball, and that's where the injury occurred. And he's on his way to the clubhouse right now. But Todd Dillon has just come in and winged a completion to McNeil, and McNeil turned it into something, and it's first and goal. Gambler got the New Jersey one. Dillon out of Cal State Long Beach. Fumbles the football and has to dive on it, and you've got penalty flag. It's tough coming off the bench. Looked like Dillon fell on the ball, but New Jersey now wants to claim it. So once again, they've got to unwrap him.
Dillon is sitting up, doesn't have the ball.
It is Houston's ball. Oh, it's not his wrist. It's a dislocated finger, we're now told. That's not official. That's the first speculation. So at least it is not the wrist. But sometimes a finger injury can take just about as long to heal.
My first year with the Pittsburgh Steelers, I was trying to catch a pass from Joe Gillum. Hit my finger, dislocated it, popped it right through the skin, Keith.
Whoa.
And that happened in the middle of the football season. And it never really healed. It's still very large calcium deposits on the knuckles, and it doesn't straighten out. Now, for me as a receiver, it's not that big a problem. But for Jim Kelly, who's got to really grip that football and throw it, it could be a problem throughout the season.
So Houston recovers it, gives it to Todd Fowler, and Dillon hands to Fowler. Fowler splits over the right side of the line behind Rosada and Khalil and sticks it in the end zone and scores his first touchdown of the season. So the Gamblers, even though they have lost Kelly for surely the rest of this ball game, they come up with a touchdown. And at 11:52 to go in the third quarter, it's a 24-15 ball game with Tony Fritsch in for the point. And now trotting back off the field. Have they decided to go for two? It appears so. It'll be the first time they have gone for two this year, if that's what they decide to do, and that's what they have in mind. And the timeout now called by New Jersey. So apparently they did not have the kind of people in they wanted to defend against a two-point conversion try by Houston. The Gamblers obviously trying to make it a 24-17 ball game. Now we come up for the two-point conversion try by the Houston Gamblers, trying to cut the margin from 9-7. Todd Dillon is your quarterback. With Kelly out, injured ring finger. Dillon keeps it, throws it. Corral, he's got it. Penalty flag down. Let's see about the penalty. Defensive holding call. Obviously declined. The two-point conversion try works, and you've now got a seven-point ball game. New Jersey 24. And Houston 17. And Todd Dillon, big shot of confidence right there.
Todd Dillon out of Cal State Long Beach, second year in the USFL. Came into the ball game, threw two passes, both passes complete. One to Gerald McNeil to set up the touchdown. On this play, he's rolling out with, of course, the option to run. Number 29, Sam Harrell, was the back. He came open briefly. Now, Sam Harrell is just backing up, and he just has to drill this to get it in there past number 47, John Joyce. He does so. Harrell comes up with the catch and shows us a little something here, Keith.
So the Houston Gamblers cash in the Herschel Walker fumble, the New Jersey turnover, and they trail now by just seven. Dillon broke many records at Cal State Long Beach, both NCAA and PCAA.
Last year, he had a chance to play in eight different ball games. He was 39 out of 80 in completions for 48.8% and 574 yards.
The holding penalty against New Jersey assessed on the kickoff, so Houston will be kicking it. Dale Walters will from the 40. And you've got Marcus Anderson back now joining Danny Knight on the kickoff return team. And there's Todd Dillon now. He got high in a hurry. And they certainly need him, what with Kelly out.
Keith, when I was down in Houston a couple of weeks ago and watched them practice, he does have a strong arm. I noticed him with confidence and ability to pick up the defensive players downfield and find his open receivers.
Ball skitters away from Harmon for a moment and then is very quickly covered by the offensive guard, Wayne Harris. And they're going to put the ball at the 17. Here's a score in the fourth quarter, a bit of a surprise. San Antonio has gone ahead of Birmingham 15-14. There was a fumble and putt choke recovered for San Antonio in the end zone. Putt's second touchdown this season. So that's where they are right now. Now let's join Tim Brandt.
Keith, I just came out of the locker room where they are working on Jim Kelly. They are taking him in now for x-rays. It is the ring finger on his right hand. He has dislocated it. When they brought him out, it was almost at a direct right angle. They tried to pop it back in. He was in a great deal of pain. They're x-raying it now to see if, in fact, the ring finger is broken.
Okay, Tim, thank you. And it's first down, New Jersey, at their own 17. They lead by 7 points. Give it to Maurice Carthen. And Carthen keeps those legs churning, and he is a tough, big back headed for the New York Giants. He comes out to about the 22-yard line before Rockamore and Bradley finally wrestle him down.
Now, you got to be careful, Keith. We know how strong Maurice Carthen is. When he's taking on people and he's got someone who's got a good hold on them, he leaves himself exposed in the rib area for another guy coming in taking the shot.
Second down at about 5 from the 22. Herschel Walker running behind Carthen gets up to near the 24. Ball came out of there, but they're calling him down.
Kiki Diallo was a man who hit him on that play. The whistle did pop out very quickly.
Here comes Kelly back in the stadium.
Jim Kelly.
He's carrying a football.
Hey, where's the music? Where's the cape?
They popped it back in place, apparently. He hasn't even got it wrapped right now, and he's going to warm up on the sideline.
Keith, I can't tell you how many times I saw Terry Bradshaw do that exact same thing in Pittsburgh. Come back and lead the team to victory.
Third and 3, Flutie on a deep drop. Throws it short to Clarence Harmon, and Harmon gets away for the first down out to the 30-yard line. Biella making the tackle. It's got to hurt.
Back up.
He's throwing the ball with fair velocity, but as time goes on, if he doesn't keep ice on it, you know it's got to swell some, and he'll probably lose some feeling in it.
Well, he's got to be tough, Keith, no matter what happens in the rest of this ball game, to come back out and continue to try and play.
Flutie gives the ball to Carthen, and Carthen runs in to number 90. And Van Hughes hangs on till help comes, and then there's a big pile and another fist fight.
One of the players, I think it was Derwood Rockmore, just jumped in on top of the pile. Running back would not go down. He jumped in on the pile. The number 73, Doug Mackey, came over because he was upset to yank him off.
The advance of the ball is out to the 32. Gain of 2 yards at second down and 8. And Kelly continues to throw the football. Now he's going to take some snaps, having had the ring finger on the right hand dislocated severely. On second and 8, Flutie gives it to Walker. Walker with that little skating step to the right and then comes whistling upfield. And gets it out to the 35. Tim Brandt is down there watching Jim Kelly throw the ball. What's it look like, Timmy?
Well, I just talked to him, Keith. He's still in a little bit of pain. I just talked to the doctor, and they're still developing the x-rays. They don't know if, in fact, it's broken or not, but he wanted to get back on the field. They have popped it back in. He just took some snaps. He says it hurts, but he can play.
He's tough. Ball is near the 37, where it's third down and a long 3 for New Jersey. 24-17, New Jersey leading, third quarter, 8-10 to go. Give it to Walker. And he's got the first down as he crosses the 40. Kika Diella finally brought him down with help from Holyfield. But Herschel is having a day.
Okay, the best way to take the motivation, the enthusiasm, the the turning tides of a particular team away is to just to grind it out, take it away from them, continue dominating the game. Whatever amount of an emotional lift that the Houston Gamblers had on that last touchdown, the New Jersey Generals are attempting to take it away with a long, sustained drive.
They've got a first down outside their own 41. Flutie.
Go deep. Oh.
Going to scramble now. Throws it short down the middle to Jeff Speck to tie it in, and Speck is run over by Andy Hawkins.
Keith, number 85, Walter Broughton, had beaten his man on the sideline and then had come across scrambling up at midfield, was wide open. The difference between a Doug Kelly, a Doug Flutie, and a Jim Kelly. Doug scrambling, looking for somebody to throw too short just to get rid of the ball. Kelly would have seen him downfield and threw the long shot. But look at the hit the number 81 takes from Andy Hawkins.
He got a first down out of it. Ball near the Houston 48-yard line. So once again, the Generals using the run primarily, this pass sparingly, moving the football.
I think what we're seeing here, Keith, is the formula that is going to be successful for the New Jersey Generals throughout the season if they stay with it.
Carthen had a little trouble getting the handle on the ball, and Anthony Holyfield, a rookie out of Hawaii, got good penetration and brought him down right about the line of scrimmage.
He is a cousin, Keith, of the boxer. Evander Holyfield, is that his first name?
Yes, Evander from
Atlanta. Holyfield.
3-3 ball game, first quarter between the Stars and the Express. And next week, we're planning the Memphis Showboats. We've got to get their boat in better water against the Baltimore Stars at Baltimore. Second down and still about 10 as Flutie goes to the sidelines and misses. Maurice Carthen threw the ball a little behind him and high. So Tim Brandt has now informed us that the information on the x-rays is there is no break in Kelly's dislocated ring finger on his right hand. They have put it back into place. He has been out and taken some snaps and thrown the ball and wants to go out and play some more.
Now, Keith, it's third down. Number 75, Chris Ream, just went into the ball game. He's an offensive tackle, but he's playing in the goal line defense for Houston.
Flutie dumps it out here to Sam Bowers, and Bowers has the first down. He got the Houston secondary preoccupied with Clarence Collins, Walter Broughton, and Herschel Walker. They had put Walker wide, and they had to be concerned with Walker. That took Kiki Diala outside to cover Walker, and all of a sudden, here comes the tight end across, and there's nobody there.
Just a little shallow crossing route. He has time to kill, so he starts backing up, waiting for Flutie to find him. Big third down play for the New Jersey Generals and sustaining a very, very long drive here in the third period.
They've got it first down just short of the Houston 30. Carthen. Big play, penalty flag. Carthen inside the 10 to the 7-yard line. But let's see about the penalty flag. Maybe a hold.
Holding, offense, 76.
Don Maggs is caught holding. The big guy out of Tulane had a season with the Maulers, and that will wipe out that big run by Maurice Carthen. Otherwise, New Jersey is first in goal at the Houston 7.
Well, that's a tough play to get caught for a penalty. All these offensive linemen are graded on the efficiency of their block, making the right blocks. Penalties or a lack of penalties each week. The coaches will look at close-up film taken from the end zone to see just exactly how they play. And when it comes to being graded out, he'll go down a notch for that one.
Marcus Anderson is in now as a wide receiver. First down and 20 for the Generals. Carthen can't get outside this time. He's pinned in. And then brought down 76. Rayford Cooks is the man that sealed it off. Van Hughes makes the tackle for the Gamblers. So back into the lineup now comes Clarence Collins, Clarence Harmon, and Sam Bowers.
Keith, you've got bodies flying all over the football field. Maurice Carthen was looking for a place to run. Herschel was on the outside trying to find the block, and he was trying to block number 57, Mike Hawkins. Mike Hawkins picked him up and slammed him to the ground.
It's second down, 20. Herschel Walker's a wide man and going downfield. Flutie's pass. Collins can't pull it down. Clarence got one hand on it and couldn't pull it in. He slipped behind Mike Mitchell. Well, Mike Mitchell was the man that Chuck Fusina and company picked on last week in the Astrodome, but today New Jersey has not exercised anything against Mike Mitchell. He's been playing his position tough.
Jim Moore told us he wasn't picking on Mike Mitchell, but I don't believe that, Keith. I think they were picking him quite a bit last week because he just went at him much too often. That time, Clarence Collins just got inside. He had a lot of room to run for the post pattern. Flutie was just a little bit too deep with that pass.
Third down and a little more than 20 now. As Flutie drops deep. Gets it off deep for Collins. Incomplete. Batted away by Mitchell. Mike Mitchell was right with him. Had him covered like an Indian blanket. And slapped it away.
When you start picking on defensive backs, they start feeling like wounded animals, Keith. You back them into a corner. They say, wait just a moment. You know, I can give up a pass or two here and there, but don't come after me every time because it's my job. I'll prove to you I'm a lot better than a touchdown here and a touchdown there. Mike Mitchell bounces back very quickly with a great play.
Rick Partridge in to punt. He'll hit it around midfield. His only kick so far today, one of 35 yards. Very dangerous man. Gerald McNeil is deep, standing back on the Houston 10. 3:40 to go, third quarter, 24-17. New Jersey leads by 7. Partridge kick is very high. McNeil circles under it, lets it go, takes a big bounce, and goes out of bounds. Went straight sideways and out of bounds at the 7-yard line.
Well, one of the most traveled men in the USFL, Jeff Partridge, gets a great punt. Kelly comes into the ball game, his team trailing 24-17.
The New Jersey Generals had the ball for 8 minutes and 21 seconds, ran off 13 plays, and had the punt. Primarily the result of the holding penalty, and Jim Kelly, who had a severe dislocation of the ring finger on his right hand, his throwing hand, put it back in place. X-ray showed no break, and he's in the ball game to take the snap right here. Kind of dangerous, because if he's lost feeling in that finger, it could be a problem. McNeil, that little pop inside. And McNeil runs it out of trouble, comes up to the 19-yard line. McNeil lost the football, had a fumble on that very play when it looked like Houston was going to score against Baltimore last week. But so far today, he's run it 3 times, and that time turned in the biggest gain.
Tough little man, went to Baylor University, actually born in Germany. Number 75, Chris Rehm, the man we mentioned who was in on the defense, is now in at the right tackle for the offensive unit.
It's first down as Kelly drops to throw, wings it out to Richard Johnson. Johnson dodges Perry Daniels. Daniels flashing across, missed him on an attempted tackle, and Richard was able to get another 6 yards out of the play.
Richard's playing extremely well, but even as well as he's playing, Keith, a lot of these plays are going for less yardage than he normally would take them for. You watch right here. He doesn't turn on the burst. He's heading right out of bounds. Normally, in this situation, he would cut to his left and try and split those 2 defensive backs and cut across field.
But he did step out just past the marker. And he's got a first down up at the 29. Johnson, 9 catches for 92 yards, averaging better than 10 yards per catch. Kelly back, gets his pass off. Pass is thrown behind Richard Johnson that time. And now Todd Dillon, the man that took Houston to the end zone after Kelly's injury with Tim Brandt.
Keith, when I was in the locker room checking on Jim Kelly, they came running in there screaming for the wristband that he wears. Tell me about the wristband and why'd you need it so badly?
Well, we send the plays in off the wristband, and they're about maybe 10 to 15 words long, and it's hard to get the play run in there and get it translated without a word loss somewhere along the way.
Did you feel awkward in there coming in that situation?
No, that's the way I like to get put in the game.
All right, Keith.
Get put in late.
Pretty cool customer. Second down and 10. Verdan fumbles the football. Penalty flag down on the field as New Jersey scrambles for it, and I think Houston's got it back. He may get a clothesline call here as Verdan is not getting up. Scott, or is it McGee? Scott McGee it is.
Number 88.
Now Scott's up, but he is woozy.
He is groggy, and I don't think he'll come back in the ballgame. Believe me, that place I am all too familiar with. It's not a good place to be. He came across and just took one right across the helmet. Now, the rules state that you cannot intentionally tackle a player around or about the head. We see number 13, Gerald McNeil, also laying on the ground, hurt from that same play. It looked as if a Houston Gambler player did recover the ball.
I think it was McNeil in pursuit of it. He might have been the one buried.
32, defense.
We'll take a look at it. You see here the play. Now right there is the hit that causes a fumble.
Ken Johnson.
Ken Johnson, number 32, likes to be called Kenny Johnson. So we won't have any problem remembering who he is now. Kenny Johnson right here comes right up around the head, just hog ties him like a steer. Brings him to the ground, and you see the ball bouncing away there.
That spot of the foul.
Hey, give me some smelling salt.
Do you want? They're all tough.
Bottle of smelling salt.
They're all tough.
They're all crazy.
It's a 19-yard catch and a 15-yard penalty, so it's a total gain of 34 yards as McNeil now. He is walking away to the bench.
And McNeil, what, he is all the way across the field. What in the world was he doing over there? And
no
how
idea.
Did he get hurt?
I don't know.
And I'll tell you one thing, Keith. I played a game against the Oakland Raiders one year when the play happened, was happening on the far side of the field, and one of the defensive backs for the Oakland Raiders came up from behind and just nailed me in the head. And there was no way an official was ever going to see it. They weren't even looking in that direction.
So two key wide receivers now are woozy. One of them hollering for smelling salts. And I don't think Gerald McNeil wants to do anything but sit down right now and try to collect his senses.
Gerald McNeil might have thought he was on his side of the field.
McGee looks all right. Whoa, did he take a whack? Clothesline. But it's a 34-yard total gain with the catch and the penalty. And Houston is on the New Jersey 36 now with a first down. 2 minutes to go, third quarter. 24-17, New Jersey by seven. Kelly looking for Corville. He's got him. And a first down at the New Jersey 15-yard line, and he just simply ran away from Gregory Johnson.
Kenny Johnson and number 27, Gregory Johnson, both combined to squeeze him. It's a post pattern, but here's where the arm of Kelly pays off. He fires it in before Corville gets into where the safety is. He knows that safety's coming up. That's why he's hesitating. He's stopping, looking for a place to run, to spin out into open territory.
Kelly is amazing, having that dislocated finger. Was at almost at right angles, and here he is back in here throwing the ball with velocity. He's 24 out of 34 for 256 yards. On the first down play, Kelly getting pressure, hit behind the line of scrimmage by Freddie Gilbert, and he's down and again may be hurt again. Looks like he took a whack with that right hand one more time, and it went down on the ground this time.
Well, anytime he places that hand down on the ground, Keith, and exerts any pressure on that finger, he's going to feel an extra amount of pain. Freddie Gilbert doing a little dance, celebrating his sack of Jim Kelly. You'll see right here, he comes from behind. Kelly sees him this time and ducks. Number 74, Jim Byrne, pops on top of him.
Ball comes back to the 23. That's a loss of 8 yards. It's second down and 18. Kelly stays in. 45 seconds to go, third quarter. Passes away and intercepted. It is picked off by Ross Armstrong as Kelly tried to force it into double coverage intended for Verdan, and Armstrong stole it. That's a second Kelly interception.
Well, here you see Jim Kelly. Again, he's trying to force it in. The receiver is open, but Armstrong just times it, cuts in front of the ball, makes a great diving catch.
So New Jersey gets the ball back at their own 11. leading by 7. So the second interception of Jim Kelly. And I don't think the sore hand had much to do with that one. He just tried to throw it in too many bodies around it.
Yep, you're right.
And New Jersey now will go to work at the 11. It's been primarily a running football team today. Big day for Herschel Walker, and he's got the ball right now. He broke one from the 12 for the first score of the ball game, traveling 88 yards, and he pops that one off the right side with some authority, gets it out to about the 19.
Okay.
That'll be the end of the third quarter as they let the clock run down. So we've played 45 minutes. It's been a lengthy ball game today. And after three, it's 24-17. New Jersey, back after this message and a word from our local station. Here we go to the final quarter now. 24-17, the Generals leading by 7. And New Jersey with the football, second down and 3, as we watch the USFL on ABC. Second and 3 for New Jersey. Carthen bouncing outside. Good play by number 57, Mike Hawkins, the left side linebacker. And he knocks him down right about the line of scrimmage. Mike playing with his brother Andy.
Now the defense really has to dig down now to try and stop the New Jersey Generals. And more so because of the clock, Keith, as opposed to the yards that they might gain while the offense possesses the ball.
Well, it's third down, and it's pretty close to 4 yards. A long three.
Now their third down conversion rate today has been pretty good.
Flutie rolling out. That's the first down. There's the quickness of Doug Flutie, and he picks up the first down. Tim Brandt now with Scott McGee.
Keith, when I talked to Gerald McNeil, he said he was punched on the other side of the field. I'm with Scott. He took a clothesline and a little bit dizzy.
Yeah, just a little bit. I'm trying to get the cobwebs out right now, but the game's turning into a very physical one at this point, you know, and it's going to be exciting. I think it's going to come down to the wire.
Are the Generals taunting you guys out there?
No, they're coming at us hard. I think both sides are playing very physical, and, you know, they're throwing some cheap shots, and I think, you know, we're just going to have to come back and play our game.
All right, Keith.
Right now, the defense has got to take the ball away because New Jersey has picked up the first down, and Flutie throws for the first time today on a first down play, and he just misses Clarence Collins. Collins turned one way. The ball wasn't there, came back the other, and by that time, he couldn't reach it as Will Lewis was defending.
Will Lewis almost had a shot to intercept that.
Whoa, hear this. Upset City, San Antonio, 15, Birmingham, 14, as you look at the replay. And Nick Mickemeyer hit 3 field goals for San Antonio. You can see that Collins was available, but the ball was behind him.
He turned inside, then he turned outside. The ball came inside, and Will Lewis came up. As you see there, the score that we just told you about, the final score, the Stallions being upset by the San Antonio Gunslingers.
The Gunslingers, who've had a rough time getting going, the 3-3 in the second quarter in Los Angeles. They beat Portland last week 33-0, and now today, good by Birmingham, 15-14. Second down and 10 for New Jersey. Just outside the 24. Flutie gives it to Walker. Hole over the left side for Herschel. Out to about the 31. They'll need about 3.5 yards for their first down with 13 minutes and 45 seconds to play in the game.
Coming up to this third down situation.
Third and 4. Flutie gives to Walker. He's close.
From the mark, he is short. No, maybe not.
Luther Bradley jumping up and down, protesting the mark.
I'm looking at the yard markers on this side. They're on our sideline, and they look like they're on, well, they're at about the 35-yard line.
Be close.
Should be on that white marker, but we'll find out just where it is once they take this measurement.
Got it. Half a ball.
Okay, huddle up.
34,500.
First down.
Well, that was a very big moment. Otherwise, they've got to punt the ball away. Crowd of 34,573 in the ballpark. Close to 47,000 tickets were sold. So it's first down for the Generals, just short of the 35. And Flutie gives to Walker. And Walker getting help around the corner. Number 76, Don Maggs, came outside and occupied the linebacker, Mike Hawkins, considerably. And Hawkins now is irate that he didn't get a call, claiming he was held by Maggs.
Maggs probably did a very professional job of holding, if he was holding at all. And, of course, professional holding means doing whatever you can do and getting away with it.
There it
you
is.
See it right there. He's got him. He's got him good. Very good job on Don Maggs' part.
Walker with 193 yards in the game now. The hot rushing games are Fowler 208, Harrell 200, and Mike Rozier 199. Ball goes to Carthen. And Carthen on second down and two picks up the first down at the 46.
Hawkins is probably still yelling out there about that last play.
He was.
I don't know. Don't worry about it too much, Mike. It's going to happen more often than not.
First down, Generals. And this time, Walker comes way wide. A little flip downfield to Walker. He's got it, gets away from Bradley for a moment, and takes it down to the Houston 35 and has a first down.
That's one of those halftime plays, Keith. When I say halftime plays, I mean a play that they saw would work at halftime and says, well, we won't worry about it. Next time we'll come out and we'll find Herschel Walker and we'll just flip it to him. Obviously, the defensive backs are not coming up on Herschel Walker, giving him a lot of room because they were afraid, you know, he might run past him or it might have been a mix-up. Anyway, Doug Flutie just pops it right to him.
Doug has now completed six balls to six different receivers. Herschel with the ball again. Into the stack this time. And maybe two on that carry. Runs into Van Hughes out of Southwest Texas.
Behind me.
The defensive line of the Houston Gamblers has to be a tired bunch. They're resorting to offensive linemen to give them a spell, to back them up when they're tired, to help them play their prevent defenses.
Walker got one, second down, nine from the 34. Carthen this time. And Luther Bradley finally drags him down inside the 30. They'll put it at the 28 and leave him 3 yards short of the first down.
That's what you call a veteran tackle there, Keith. Luther Bradley is 6'2 and weighs 195, and Maurice is 6'1, weighing 220. Now, he's not giving away a lot in height and size, but he does give away a lot in power. So instead of taking Maurice Carthen head on, he wraps his arms around him, gets a good grip, and then just kind of rides him to the turf, making sure of the tackle and that he won't get away.
Third down. Long three here. Flutie rolls it out. He's got room, and he's got the first down. Flutie steps out of bounds just inside the 22.
And the light rain is starting to come down now, Keith. Very light mist. I'm just hoping one thing on this Easter Sunday. It doesn't turn into snow.
Tomorrow's going to have snow flurries. That's exercising your talent right there, isn't it?
That is, but it's all a result of the great day that Herschel Walker is having on the ground. Doug Flutie came into this ballgame somewhat miffed about taking so much criticism for his play as a leader and the quarterback for the Generals. A lot of that pressure has been taken off by Herschel Walker this afternoon.
Flutie is 40 yards on four carries. Walker goes slashing into the middle and moves the ball. He's close to the 16-yard line.
Walker.
But that's one of the differences, Keith, in being a college player and being a professional. Once you start getting paid to do a job, well, part of that entails being able to take the criticism and always having the eye of the media upon you.
Herschel now with 198 yards at the fourth biggest game in USFL history, and he's got 9 minutes and a half to go in this game. It seems certain he'll be beyond 200. And who knows, he may set a new rushing record. Walker again. He's inside the 10, and he's got a first down for the New Jersey Generals, and that puts him at 205 yards, just 3 yards short of Todd Fowler's all-time best in the USFL.
He just squeezed right in between Todd Fowler and Sam Harrell. But number 27, Luther Bradley, was shaken up on the play.
He and Walker butted heads, I think.
Oh, what a losing battle for Luther. We'll take another look. Maurice Carthen out in front. Maurice Carthen just pushing Herschel, pushing Luther. I think someone stepped on his head.
Looked like it. 8:56 to go in the ball game, New Jersey. First and goal at the Houston 9. Well, the punishing ground game of New Jersey today. This drive started with 38 seconds left in the third quarter. Now we're in the fourth quarter with 8:45 to play in the game. Kelly staying warm on the sidelines. And New Jersey just pounding along. Walker with 205 yards, and he's the lone remaining back, and he's got it one more time. And he gets maybe two on that carry. That'll get him up to 207 and leave him 1 yard short of the USFL record. Second down and goal from the Houston 7.
That's Clark Gaines, who coaches the running backs. Played for the New York Giants, standing next to, played for the Jets, standing next to Walt Michaels.
Harmon lines up with Walker. Flutie keeps it. Gets around the corner. Touchdown. Will Lewis slipped and fell in the end zone. He outran Rayford Cooks. Lewis, trying to cover the receiver in the end zone, could not come back to help out. And Flutie ankles in.
Well, Doug Flutie not being satisfied to stay in the role of the guy handing off to Herschel Walker, or the throwing occasional pass. Works the bootleg to perfection, the naked bootleg, no one out in front of him to block. He goes it alone for the 6 points.
Well, he's run for 4 first downs today, and now he has scored a touchdown from 7 yards. Ruzek for the extra point. 8:02 to go in the ball game, and it's now New Jersey 31 and Houston 17. And the heat's on a sore-handed Jim Kelly and company.
There's a professional football league that believes having fun is the most important business at hand. The USFL, where football is still a game.
The preceding message was furnished by the United States Football League.
31-17, New Jersey leading. You'd think that might be secure with 8:02 to play, but not so with Houston. They marched 89 yards, 16 plays, and burned up 7:36 off the clock. Ruzek kicks off, high and short. Eason. And Eason comes out to the 28-yard line, where he's brought down. And the Gamblers get the ball with 7:53 to play in the game. Doug Flutie, 6 out of 13 for 82 yards in passing. He's run for 47 yards, 4 first downs, and now 1 touchdown from 7 yards out. There's a scoring drive, but in the second half, it's been New Jersey just simply possessing the ball, 17 minutes plus. Gerald McNeil is back in the lineup as Houston goes to work, and that pass is deflected at the line of scrimmage.
Again, there was number 90, Freddie Gilbert, who deflected this pass. And we have to give some credit to the defensive coordinator for the New Jersey General, Dell Lindsey. He's been playing most of this ball game with 4 defensive linemen. You see number 90, Freddie Gilbert, right there, going in, getting his hand up in the air, knocking the pass down. one middle linebacker, that's been Bobby Leopold, and six defensive backs throughout the afternoon who have been inflicting punishment.
Kelly caught, and the pass is almost intercepted by Bobby Leopold, but they're calling him in the grass back around the 21-yard line. Whistle stopped it. Jim Byrne had him to the leg, and that's the third sack for the New Jersey defense. They put it on the 22. Kelly now is 24 out of 36 for 256 yards. Of course, that won't go as a pass. It was whistled in. From the 22, back goes Kelly again. On third down and long, shoots it up the middle. The pass is caught, but it is short of the first down by Clarence Verdan. They've marked Clarence down around the 33, and he had to go to the 38 to get the first down. So it is fourth down and five, and they're going for it.
Well, I think they have to.
7 minutes to play in the game. They trail by 14. Kelly rolls out, going to run for it. Penalty flag down. Kelly dives, and I don't think the mark is good enough to get him his first down. Bobby Leopold got a hold of him. Kelly trying to spin it upfield. They have marked him short of the first down, but let's see about the penalty. That might have wiped it out anyway.
Oh, offense.
Against the offense.
Dan Rosado, the right guard out of Northern Illinois, is a rookie.
Now the mark looks like it would have been a first down.
It goes for naught.
Well, they'll measure to make sure, because if it is not a first down, obviously New Jersey wants the football there. So they're going to bring that chain out and make sure no eyeballing here.
You betcha.
6 minutes and 49 seconds to play.
Walt Michaels standing right behind the officials.
If it is a first down, they will accept the penalty. If it is not a first down, they'll decline the penalty and take the ball.
It's a first down, so they'll take the penalty. So the ball will back up. It will once again be fourth down for the Houston Gamblers, and let's see with a little more distance whether
don't
they
you have to punt it here, though.
Well, I think with 6:49 and trailing by 14, the way that New Jersey is possessing the football, you should go ahead and take a shot here. You
don't know. 16, though. That's a lot.
I know, but you don't know when you're going to get the ball back. They've been able to possess the ball for 7 minutes and 39 seconds, 8 minutes and 21 seconds, and 7 minutes and 42 seconds on previous drives.
Passes away. Verdan drops it. Penalty flag. McNeil dropped it. McNeil, 13. Let's see about the penalty.
They're pointing at John Preston, at least the Jack Pardee. And the Houston Gamblers are pointing at number 25, John Preston. He was covering Johnson on the play.
Oh, no. Defense, number 37. First down.
Oh, boy. Jerry Holmes got flagged for it. Holding. And that carries a first down with it.
Which?
Well, that's a big, big break. That's the second time that Houston has had a big break on a holding call. So now with 6.5 minutes to play in the game, instead of Houston giving up the ball and New Jersey setting on their side of the field, the Gamblers now have it first down at their own 28.
But they could have been better off had little Gerald McNeil held on to that pass.
Yes, indeed. This is to Richard Johnson, and he drops the ball. Same play, except it was Johnson, and it was on his hands, and he dropped it.
Keith, let's call down there to director Craig Jenoff and see if that wasn't a replay of the last play. I don't know. I mean, you might be concerned about the hitting, but Johnson said the hitting wasn't going to bother him. They were just going to have to play it tough. That one just went right through his hands.
Stay back now. Stay back. Give John room.
Lack of concentration there.
So it's second down and 10. Kelly runs away from the pressure, going to run with it. And gets a first down as he comes up near the 40. With Birmingham losing today, they're now in a tie at 5-2 with Tampa Bay in the Eastern Conference. And New Jersey, if they hold on to win, will go to 4-3, just a game off the pace.
Mark Bruce, number 82, coming into the ballgame. Kelly probably a little bit upset having his passes drop like that, but he can't let that frustration get to him at this moment. He's got to try and find a receiver who can get down the field and score very, very quickly.
6:02 to play in the ballgame. 31-17, Generals lead. Penalty flag as Kelly shoots one down the middle, and the pass is caught for a first down around the 43, but let's see about the penalty. You might have an offensive holding call right here.
Illegal motion. Offense. Right back.
So that wipes out the big play. In the Western Conference, if Houston loses today, it means that Denver and Oakland will be playing at Denver. Denver and Arizona will be playing for a first place tie at Denver tomorrow night. I think Arizona showed everybody last night that they're getting tougher and tougher under Frank Kush.
Well, the Houston Gamblers are making it very difficult on themselves, trying to come back here in the fourth quarter with 5:40 to play and penalty after penalty.
First and 15. Kelly's pass is away. McNeil did not run the fly. He stopped short in front of Jerry Holmes. Kelly let the ball go. So they just simply read each other wrong on that play. On second and 15, Kelly with time. Goes down the middle for Richard Johnson. Can't quite run it down.
And he limps a little bit too on that play, Keith.
If he's healthy, he catches that ball and scores.
Well, even not healthy, it looks like he could have laid down and caught it. Well, he's coming right off to the sideline because I think he hurt his hamstring again, Keith.
He's
signaling he wants to come out. He was limping on the last part of that pattern he ran too.
Herschel Walker is 1 yard away from the USFL best game ever on the ground by Todd Fowler of these Houston Gamblers. Right now, the Gamblers controlling the ball, but trailing by 14 points, 5:25 to play in the game. Third and 15. Kelly's pass to Burdan, and he's caught it for a first down near the New Jersey 43. Gregory Johnson, the coverage.
Oh, he threw that one under pressure. The pocket closing in all around Jim Kelly. We'll look at Clarence Verdan. He gets inside of Terry Daniels. They have six defensive backs. He's just reading him right there, trying to work open.
Kelly's pass thrown out of bounds. Incomplete, stops the clock at 4:52 to play in the ball game.
Well, the fans are booing a little bit, thinking that Kelly should be flagged for intentional grounding, but he had a receiver near the sideline, which means he can throw it in the upper rafter if he wants to.
Richard Johnson has now come back.
Back it up.
Maybe he was just tired then. By the way he's dragging that leg, he is not the man to go to on the deep route to score quickly in this drive.
Second and 10 on the 44 of New Jersey. Kelly gets it off, pass is caught by Todd Fowler coming out of the backfield. And the big back jams ahead with Bobby Leopold hanging on to him and gets the first down.
And also the designated hitman, strong safety number 25, John Preston from Central State. He comes up and he gets a piece of Todd, but Todd gets the best of him.
Kelly now is thrown for 301 yards, dislocated finger or no. There's a little flip pass intended for Fowler, and it's deflected at the line of scrimmage by Freddie Gilbert now, who has become a personal tormentor.
Well, coming in from the outside, Keith, at his right defensive end position, he is not trying to charge inside, but more straight up the field, getting in the line of fire of Jim Kelly when he's trying to throw to the outside. And all defensive linemen are taught, once you see the passer about to throw the ball, get your free hand up in the air in his face and try and distract him or knock the ball down.
Ball is on the New Jersey 33. We're at second and 10. 4:19 play in the game. 14-point New Jersey lead. Kelly's pass down the middle. Richard Johnson bobbling. Can't hold on to it. John Preston rode Johnson down, and Richard simply could not hang on to it. Never did get a real grip on it.
No, he didn't.
They're looking at third and 10 now.
We call those five-yard catches, and my coach, Lionel Taylor, always said we never had time for them. His coach, Robert Ford, makes his receivers, every time they bobble the ball like that, drop down and do 15 push-ups when they're in practice. Yep. At this rate, he's got a lot of push-ups when he gets back to Houston.
Third and 10. Kelly to the end zone.
Touchdown.
Touchdown. Great, great catch by Clarence Verdan. They're going for two.
And they're going for all they can get right now. Trying to catch up. He just takes off straight down the field. And he's just going to outrun the coverage using all of his speed. Three people around him, a perfectly thrown pass by Jim Kelly. Outstretched arms, he catches it, has control, falls down. 6 points when you need it most.
John Preston, Gregory Johnson, and Ross Armstrong were the three defenders, and Kelly now with 333 yards on 28 completions and 47 attempts. And they're going for two. Pitches it back to Fowler. And he runs a little option action down the line, flips the ball back to Todd Fowler, and he walks in free and clear, and it's 31-25.
Jim Kelly grimacing as he comes off after that option play. Obviously, he's hurt the hand again, but I'm sure he'll stay in. Another look. Great pass and catch. Kelly to Verdan. Take another look at the conversion. It's an old option play. He brings in Freddie Gilbert, fakes it, then pitches it as he's hit by Freddie Gilbert. So he takes a little punishment for Todd Fowler to go in for the 2 points.
So they trail by six now with 4:05 to play in the ball game. Tony Fritch is out on the field to kick. So immediately you think onside kick. He has now come up and assessed the territory that he wants to kick the ball, which is 10 yards or more.
And if you look at the kickoff return team for the New Jersey Generals, you've got Danny Knight out there, receiver. You've got Broughton out there, who's a receiver. You've got all people with good hands. Bobby Leopold, Kenny Johnson, Clarence Collins, Sam Bowers, Gregory Johnson.
He kicks it over to the left, and Gregory Johnson fields it at the Houston 47, and then steps out of bounds. And so the New Jersey Generals, with 4:02 to play, lead by six and have the ball at the Houston 47. Now what Walt Michaels wants is possession. 4:02 to play in the game. His team is leading by 6 points. And I would think very quickly here, Herschel Walker could go into the record books as the most prolific rusher in the young USFL history. He has 207 yards.
I think that'll happen probably, Keith, on the first play right here.
He's got it. And he goes from the 47 down to about the 43 for a total of 211 yards, surpassing the league record of Todd Fowler at 208 yards. Looks like Luther Bradley back in the ball game. Hawkins, number 57, was slow getting up, but Bradley is back out on the field after having a sprained ankle. It'll be second down and six now for New Jersey.
The reason why Pardee opted to go for the onside kick was because he wanted to get the ball back, yes, but also to keep it away from the possession offense of the New Jersey Generals, as they have dominated this ball game with ball control.
Walker again, big hole over the left side, and runs for a first down inside the 35 to the 34. Number
So he's really putting a lock on the rushing record.
Well, you see the offensive line. Look at that charge. They just get off the line of scrimmage before Herschel Walker even makes or begins to make contact with any player from the Houston Gamblers. He is already 5 yards downfield, Keith. Now those guys are just plumb worn out from today's activity.
Yep. Walker now totals 220 yards. Carson this time, and Carson has the big hole over the left side. And a very hard runner, and he's close to another first down. They get him at the 25, and that'll be roughly a yard and a half short of the first down. They just have not been able to stop New Jersey's ground game. Clock is rolling at 2.5 minutes to play in the game. 31-25, the score, the Generals lead. Is free and gets the first down as he goes inside the 20 to the 19, and he now has 226 yards.
2 minute warning.
Exactly 2 minutes left to play in the football game. New Jersey possessing the ball and eating up the clock, leading by 6 points. A very tired Houston defense trying to find a way to stop the Generals. They total 331 yards on the ground today in Swan. Walker's gone for 226, Carthen 58, and Flutie 47.
Well, it had to be the obvious game plan, knowing that the defense of the Houston Gamblers was worn out at the defensive line position. Let your offensive people try and wear them out, at least get them more run conscious than anything else before you start throwing the football.
They got Walker up in a slot position now, and Carthen the lone remaining back. On first down from the 19, give it to Carthen. And never really found any place to go that time. He wiggles back to the line of scrimmage, and then he is thrown back. And Kika Diallo jumps into the crowd yelling timeout for Houston. And so the Houston Gamblers now spending a timeout. They'll have two left. Jim Kelly, the Houston quarterback, waiting and hoping. Right now, the problem rests for Houston with their defensive unit trying to control New Jersey's ground game. It'll be second down and 9 for the Generals. The ball will be placed down at the Houston 18. 1:49 to play. Houston with 2 timeouts remaining. New Jersey has 2. You know, after this play, Houston's going to call another one. Flutie keeps it, gets loose on the corner, slowed down, and is finally thrown down at about the 13. Short of the first down. Van Hughes came out, just couldn't quite get to it.
Now Doug Flutie had to pick up some very excellent blocks from his linemen in order to get out just that far to be short of a first down. The temperatures have dropped dramatically here, Keith, and that very light mist continues to come down onto the field.
Yeah, it's a low 50s, maybe even less, huh?
Yeah, I think it's closer to maybe 47 in that area.
It'll be third down and a long 3 for New Jersey.
What the Gamblers are hoping for right here is something just short of a miracle in the form of a turnover. Give them a chance, any kind of a chance.
Walker to the outside, has the first down. Herschel Walker broke it outside, and the defenders got caught inside, and nobody could get over there to struggle with him. And the Generals may have slammed the door right there.
Well, 1:31 in the ball game and counting. They're certainly not going to call a timeout to give that man, Jack Pardee, any chance to come back in the ball game.
The field goal would make it 34-25. There's
good shape right now. Herschel totals 232. The top rushing game ever in the USFL. And Walker is out of there. Flutie mixed up in the play, wanted to give it to Carson, and Doug slides down back at the nine. He went down rather than take a hit, and he was certainly going to get a hit. He turned around. Clarence Harmon had come in replacing Walker. Somebody was out of position. He turned around, looked like he wanted to give it to Carson, but Maurice wasn't there.
That's it. Well, the Gamblers aren't calling a timeout. I don't think they have any left. They have one left. They didn't call a timeout. Second down. The Generals really do not have to turn the ball over. They can just sit on it at this point.
They give it to Carthen, and he runs it inside the five to the four. And so they've only got to snap it. Well, I don't even have to snap it, do they?
Nope. Unless they call a timeout, they don't have to do anything.
They surely will spend the last timeout here.
No, I don't think they will. I think the Gamblers have basically thrown in the towel. 8 seconds of counting. They'll let it run off.
So Herschel Walker winds up with 232 yards, which is a new USFL record, as the Generals total 343 yards in the ball game, which is also a team record in the USFL. And here's Tim Brandt with Herschel Walker.
All right, Keith, a whole lot of work today. 232 yards, a new record.
Well, I think a lot of credit should go to the offensive line, because they've been coming on strong each week, and they're moving Houston off the ball, and I think they just played a terrific game, and it just happened that I was running tough, and we happened to make things happen.
First of all, we touched on this earlier in the ball game when we talked during the game after your long run, but coming into this game, knowing that their offensive line with Caton and Taylor and all those guys out of the game, banged up, was it your game plan just to go right at them time and time again?
Well, not really, because when you're in pro ball, I don't care if you got the first team out, the second team was just as good. And I think our game plan was to control the ball, because we knew if you give Kelly time with the ball, he's going to score. That was something we didn't want to do. We wanted to try to control the ball and take it down the field.
All right, Herschel, congratulations on the new record.
Thank you.
Okay, Keith.
Big day for the big man from Georgia. Once again, your final score, the New Jersey Generals 31 and the Houston Gamblers 25. And so New Jersey now is just a game away from the lead in the Eastern Conference, and Houston is about to be tied for the lead in the Western Conference. The United States Football League, an exclusive presentation of ABC Sports, brought to you today by Ryder Truck Rental. When you move it yourself, it's Ryder or it's wrong. By Kodakolor VR Films, bringing American home in all of its glorious color, Kodak film, because time goes by. By patented Shell SU-2000 Super Unleaded Gasoline, turn your car into an SU-2000 performer. And by Diet Coke, with 100% NutraSweet, it's one of a kind. Travel arrangements made through, promotional fee paid by United Airlines. United flies to Tokyo from more top business centers with three-class Royal Pacific service. This has been a presentation of ABC Sports, recognized around the world as the leader in sports television.